Welcome, my name is Lotte Juul-Petersen, Wysing's curator, and today we're really pleased to welcome you for our first summer camp symposium, which is part of our artistic program entitled Wysing Poly. We are really grateful that Professor Gavin Butt has divided this day for us entitled Collective Creation Between Welfarism and Austerity. And we are really grateful that Gavin has brought so many special contributors to this day. Gavin Butt, he's a professor of visual culture and performance at Goldsmiths College, and for a number of years he has been working in the intersection between art history, performance theory, and queer theory. He's an author of Between You and Me, Queer Disclosures in New York, Art World, and co-author of Visual Culture as Seriousness, and editor of Art Criticism, New Responses to Art and Performance. I've also been following Gavin during his time where he set up where he co-directed Performance Matters from 2009 to 2013, a creative research project exploring the culture value of performance. And he's also a co-editor of This Is Not a Dream, a documentary film exploring artists do-it-yourself using use of moving image technology. He's currently completing a new book entitled Anti-Gravitas, Queer Importance in Arts and Performance, and is engaged in research on punk, post-punk culture and British art schools. So we're really pleased that he's actually, with all of his research, shaping this whole day. We would like to pay attention as well that we are live broadcasting this event, so please switch off any electricity devices. And throughout the day, we will be taking questions for the panel, obviously in this space, but also via Twitter and email. So there's a tweet here. John, he's happy to also get questions via Twitter, but also on his email, john.bloomfield@wysingartcenter.org. So without further ado, I will now hand it over to Gavin, who will introduce the whole day. But just a huge thanks for making this happen, Gavin, and for everyone who's contributing to this day. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming on such a beautiful summer's day. Well, there is some sunshine out there, but at least it's warm. We have, I hope, a great afternoon of discussion ahead of us. The title of today you can see there on the screen. I just wanted to give you a little bit of a sense of why we're here today. And it's really at the behest of Donna and Lottie, the organisers here at Wysing, and the theme that they've chosen for their various activities this year, which is Wysing Poly. They are interested in the poly... Oh, sorry. They are interested, under the auspices of this theme, Wysing Poly, they're interested, obviously, in the historically in the British polytechnics and the kind of education that they offered, especially to art students and students of technology. But they're also interested in various contemporary initiatives to provide alternatives to established art schools, especially with the various free schools that are kind of cropping up all over the country. And of course, the reason why these have cropped up is because of the increased costs to higher education introduced by the Condem government. So it was really in the context of that theme that they approached me to curate today's activities, and that's because I'm currently researching a book on British art schools and the post-punk scene in the late 1970s, early 1980s, and more specifically upon the scene in the city of Leeds. It'll probably become apparent as we move through today's activities why the focus on Leeds needs and why that specific scene seems so necessary to study and so also so pertinent to various things that are going on in today's culture. But suffice to say, one of the main reasons that I'm undertaking the research is because although art schools are famed for schooling people in various forms of creative individualism, what's remarkable about these years in Leeds, between the two art schools, the art school that was located at Leeds Polytechnic and the one that was just up the road at the University of Leeds, was that a lot of people actually moved away from an individualist creative practice, from that kind of individualist focus, and got together in bands of various and groups of various different kinds in order to engage in collective creative practice. A lot of these collectives were music bands, and we'll talk about those, but not solely. It was also a period for experimental collective activity in theatre and performance, and we'll focus on that in our second session this afternoon, but also incredible curatorial activity as well. And I just note here the feminist collective pavilion group, a feminist photography collective that was established in Leeds in the early 1980s. So all of these things I'm interested in. All of these things brought me to Wysing, and I was then given the very nice kind of invitation to extend that invitation to others. And I'll talk about that. I'll talk about the guests in a moment. But really, why is that important? Why is it important we go back to the late 70s and early 80s? Well, in part because there was then a very peculiar demographic of students who were going to study in higher education institutes, and particularly at art school at that time. And because the 70s and 80s were in the middle of what is now a very narrow historical window, when we had free higher education in the UK. It actually only extended from 1962 to 1989. Of course, it's now very much over. There was a lot of working class kids that went to study at art school. And part of my thesis is to explore what the conditions of possibility were for such a kind of cross-class demographic at art school, and what that allowed to take place, what that allowed to happen culturally, if you will. And so that's one of the things that I hope we will explore today. And also we will explore some of the conditions that made that demographic possible. And that was, of course, the social democratic consensus of the post-war British state that had really been in place since the 50s through till the late 70s, early 80s, when the Thatcher government began to unpick it. So really one of the moments we're going to be focusing on today is, if you like, positioned historically on the eve of neoliberalism, on the eve of Thatcher's victory at the polls in 1979, and then all of the kind of transformations that were brought in Thatcher's wake, effectively, and we're still caught in that wake as we sit here today. Now, those times may feel, to some, curiously, like today. Right, and we've been already, some of us have been talking about this. It may be that the Tories are now back in power and they are continuing to dismantle the organs of the state as they had begun to do in the 1980s. So it's almost as if Cameron and Osborne and presumably Theresa May will go on to continue the work that Thatcher started in the 1980s. There is some, I think, truth in those continuities between then and now. if you will. But it also very changed circumstances in which we live as well. And I want us to, as we move through the day, to explore some of the kind of, if you like, the similar conditions and the changed conditions, economic, social, cultural, between the late 70s, early 80s, and today. And that's because it seems to me that there is a lot of kind of new energy from a new generation of creative practitioners who are engaged in various forms of collective creation, which to some degree are redolent of some of the activities of the late 70s and early 80s. The DIY ethos, for instance, is extremely strong in a lot of people who are involved in collective projects, especially fashioning and establishing cultural spaces and communities, which are very much self-organized and run along collectivist lines and according to collectivist principles. In many ways, some of these contemporary projects, some of these contemporary communities, like the communities which comprise DIY Space for London, for example, which we'll hear about that project a little later, or whether it's the Music Space Chunk in Leeds, or even indeed Wharf Chambers in Leeds. In many ways, these newer, more recent projects learn the lessons of earlier forms of collectivism, whether it's, you know, thinking about how and why such earlier collectivist projects ended, or why indeed they might be seen to have failed. So there is some, I think, historical reflection built in to the ways in which some of these projects have been organized, and if you like, the ethos of the ways in which individuals relate to one another within them. So that's something that we're going to very much explore throughout the day. You may have noticed that the people who are speaking here today come from various different fields of activity, from different disciplines, from music, from art, from activism. And that's something that I really wanted to be a feature of our discussions today, because both then and now, it seems to me that these specific forms of collective activity that we want to explore seem to kind of license disciplinary crossings and encourage people to work, you know, beyond, if you like, narrow enclosures of disciplinary specialism. So if you like, the idea of the cultural commons is something that we might want to speak about, to think about the cultural field as a kind of open, kind of unlimited field of activity in which practitioners can move, maybe not with ease, but can move between different kinds of activity, between activism and music making, for example. So that's just some of the broader issues that I hope we're going to cover today. But without further ado, I want to turn to the first panel, which is called the Post-Punk Art School. So we're really going to start back there in the 1970s. And we're also, and I don't apologize for this, we're going to go to Leeds. And this is not simply because I am researching a book on that city, but it is also because our first two contributors both studied as art students in Leeds in the mid-1970s, one at the Fine Art Department at the University and one at the Polytechnic. Now, before I introduce the two of them, I just wanted to say a little bit about that scene and those schools. They were very, very different. Leeds Polytechnic was famed for its permissive pedagogy. It encouraged students to work very much across different disciplines. It was one of the only art schools at the time where you didn't have to specialize in terms of media, you know, as a painter or as a sculptor, for example. And it was also a place that was famed for the teaching of performance art, most notably because of Jeff Nuttall of People Show, who taught there. The university had a very different kind of reputation, especially towards the late 70s, after the appointment of T.J. Clark, the Marxist historian of art in 1976. It became famed as a place for kind of radical thinking around art and art history, specifically Marxist and feminist schools of thought, with Griselda Pollock and Fred Orton teaching there, and Terry Atkinson, amongst others. So what I am interested in is, given what now, retrospectively, look like such amazing, radical, pedagogically kind of oriented art schools, why a lot of students who studied there actually seem to turn away from that and to turn to their peers, to themselves, in order to make contemporary culture. Why was it that the art school, to some at least, even though the kind of radical art school, seemed moribund or insufficient in some kind of way in terms of the resources, the intellectual resources, and et cetera, that it offered. But what it did offer, of course, was 3 years to do your own thing at the state's expense. And so it offered time. And time is a rare commodity. And I think what we're going to hear is from our two speakers is what was possible with that time at that time. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first two contributors. I'm very pleased and very excited to say we have Green Gartside with us today, who is the creative force of the band Scritti Politti, of course. Formed in 1978 in Leeds, Scritti were initially a left-wing inspired post-punk British rock group that later developed into a more mainstream pop music project in the early to mid-1980s and enjoyed significant success in the music charts in the UK and the US. The group's most successful album, 1985's Cupid and Psyche 85, was innovative in its early use of the techniques of sampling and MIDI sequencing and produced hit singles including Perfect Way, The World Girl, Would Bees, and Absolute. He returned to music making in the 1990s, releasing two critically acclaimed albums in 1999 and in 2006. The success of the 2006 Mercury Music Prize nominated White Bread Black Beer LP is considered to be a major comeback. And then we will hear from Kevin Lysette, who accidentally founded the slightly legendary Mekons whilst being an art student at Leeds University. Then, while his colleagues leapt as if burnt from the battered shell of Leeds during the 80s, he unaccountably decided to stay on and became heavily involved in the post-punk scene, producing records, sound engineering, and directing videos for a whole slew of bands such as Red Lorry, Yellow Lorry, Sisters of Mercy, The March Violets, FSK, Exmoor Deutschland, and others. Kevin formed a couple of other bands, one of which, the Hill Bandits, is currently being rubbed down and getting its shoes inspected before being let out for another trot around. Kevin is also a visual artist and has had several solo and group shows. He is currently working on a solo show to be held in Leeds in October 2016. Now, the format of these, we've got about an hour and a quarter, I think it is. No, an hour we've got now. I've spoken far too long, will be that both Green and Kevin will speak for about 10 to 15 minutes, and then we will initiate a discussion, and then we'll very quickly open up to discussion. Today is meant to be an informal exchange around some of the issues of the day. So that's why we're arranged as we are. So please feel free to chip in. It doesn't have to even be a question, it can be an observation. We're a small, intimate bunch, maybe we're even a group, I don't know. Let's see what we can do with the groupness of the group today. So please join me in welcoming Green Gartside.
Can you hear me? Yeah? Even if I talk quietly? Yes? Okay, good. So I'm pretty terrified, that's the first thing to say. Much more frightening than doing a gig or anything, and I found playing gigs terrifying. I didn't play live for 20 years because of panic attacks, so I've only started doing that again recently. So I'm going to rely on notes a bit. I hope to kind of commit a lot of this to memory, but it's way too scary for me to attempt that. And keeping journals and notes is something I've done since Leeds, kind of, not obsessively, but extensively. And, you know, this is a kind of book that I would have had at Leeds kept, making notes, tons. I still have lots and lots of books like this from my time at Leeds. What I'm going to start by doing, if that's right with you, is what you should do is stop me when 15 minutes is up, because I will waffle on,
all right.
You know. And I'm going to begin with a description, if that's okay, of what it was like at Leeds in those early years. So there was no teaching at Leeds. I'll begin by saying that. The staff were all nominally practicing artists. I thought they were a lazy, cynical, self-absorbed group of men, and they were very much men. One of their number described them as a forceful and testosterone-loaded team. Jesus Christ. And they spent most of their time wholly absent, or they were drinking in the bars and pubs of the Polytechnic and nearby, and only occasionally would they have a kind of aggressively taciturn wander around the sort of horrible big neon-lit studio. And this awful situation, I think, was it was the inevitable entropy of a laissez-faire approach in an institution built on cronyism, anti-intellectualism, and principally, most importantly, on unexamined romanticist notions about art and artists, about creativity and meaning. And they also had in the background theories of free schooling and de-schooling, which are contentious, and self-expression theories and so-called student-centered learning. This was basically what turned out to be a toxic mix, I think. Jeff Nuttall, who you mentioned, was my personal tutor. he wrote, because art is irrational in nature, it can only be irrationally understood. I've no idea what he meant, but, you know, recently, I'll just read, an admirer of Jeff Nuttall, I found this a couple of days ago, wrote, partly quoting Jeff Nuttall, my tutor, he treats the labour movement with sneering derision. He scorns their union representatives as well as their angry young working class intellectuals. He ridicules the cosy-minded liberal left-wing intellectuals for being faithful to the pathetic fallacy of placing issues before instinct. So mind and passion were robbed of any real authenticity, and morality was consequently devitalised. He arrogantly condemns them for having constructed a left-wing romanticism based on that patronising idealisation of the lumpen proletariat that only the repressed children of the middle class could have contrived. You know, that kind of complete unreconstructed romanticist tosh was, you know, it would have been nice to be able to talk to him about that, but he was either absent, drunk, or a bullying, intimidating presence. The students, consequently, at Leeds were left, I don't know, anybody here was at Leeds at the time? No, good. I'm making all this up. No. Anyway, so the students were left totally to their own devices, you know, and whatever ideas they had about what art was and what artists were, when they were at school, when they were school children, that's what they were left with at Leeds. And I mean, I didn't want to be told what to do at Leeds, that's the last thing I wanted, but I would have liked a discussion. I would have liked the possibility of asking some questions and getting some answers. And there was also, I should add, the odd formalist slouching about who thought everything extraneous to art should be purged from it, and which would have left them with very little to talk about. candidly. So I was thrown back on my own resources, as they say, you know, to ask questions and find answers to the most fundamental issues, it seemed to me, how meaning, value and significance are ascribed to a work of art and how meaning, value and significance are ascribed to the practice of art. I did foundation at Newport, my hometown. It was the done thing then to do a sort of foundation year in the college that was near where you lived. And then go on to... I went to Leeds because of its reputation. It was, Patrick Heron said of it, it was the most important college in Europe since the Bauhaus. And that was, you know, that's enough to make anybody want to go. And when I went and had a look at it, you know, I looked at lots of colleges, Chelsea, tons of them. And when I got to Leeds, it was, you know, everybody was doing performance art. And, you know, they were shooting budgerigards in cages and they were strangling voles and making themselves sick. And, I mean, it's very exciting when you're, you know, 17. And you think that possibly there's some, you know, deep thought had gone on behind this. So that's why I chose Leeds, should you be interested. So, so I was just familiar because at Newport, by the way, there was a chap called Keith Arnott, who was a conceptual artist. You know, he took photos of himself with "I am an artist" in front, and I thought that was very interesting. And through him, I was just familiar a little with the early writings of the Art and Language group, who initially, very simply put, asserted that if you were making paintings, then you're already accepting, not questioning, the nature of art. And all my contemporaries at Leeds, well, the new intake, were very timidly making, you know, paintings, and the staff weren't talking to them, and it was a terrible state of affairs. I was excited about the challenge of conceptual arts, more specifically the challenge of the work of art and language. It was more exciting than another canvas or another sculpture. The question was more stimulating than another object or another goofy or gross-out performance or another film loop going through the... You know, we had all of that. And the questions were much more exciting than the rest of it. How am I doing time-wise?
Fine.
Am I? Okay. So the kind of, what I would do at the time, this is when I first got to Leeds, I think, I would, you know, use my, they kept trying to throw me out of the college for not making art. So I would put things on, very similar to what's on the wall out there, sort of writings. You know, Art Language had kind of done that before. But I used my studio space for that, and I would, you know, the kind of thing that I would put up would be things like, you know, it's obvious that a painting can't ask questions about the ontological status of painting or art. You know, I'd put that up and see if anybody, a lecturer, would like to come and talk to me about that. No, none of them ever did. You know, and how many more gestures or objects can restate Duchamp's question? I put that up the next week and no one would want to talk to me about that, you know. How many more distributions and arrangements of paint will have any significance beyond decoration? And you know, in the whole thing, you know, how many more artists, you know, declaring one way or another that he or she is an artwork, you know, would it be needed for the point to be made? And there was clearly a political and a social dimension to all of these questions. And I didn't just want to go to the library and sit down and read, you know, Suzanne Langer or Greenberg or Rosenberg or any art theories. What I wanted to do was to ask my own questions and make the act of questioning the practice of art my art. That seemed a very... important. So that led me to try and get to grips on my own, which is ridiculous, really. With the contemporary writers, that, you know, not exactly contemporary, but the people I turned to were Wittgenstein, Quine, you know, Austin, Althusser, the Frankfurters, and many, you know, analytic Marxist structuralist writers. And much of what there is in all of those writers' work served to critically undermine the romanticist assumptions about art and artists at Leeds. You know, ideas about individualism, imagination, authenticity, inspiration, honesty, purity, expressivity, spontaneity, intuition. I've got a great list here. Emotion, feeling, you know, absolute originality, genius. You know, the romantic ideas of meaning and communication, they were all bound up with what, you know, we called a metaphysics of presence. That was the Derridean thing. You know, an assumption of immediate available area of certainty. And that's what the Romanticists believed that art provided, really. And it would, you know, and the Romanticists, they were still Romanticists, whether they were obsessed with pursuing ever more pictorial flatness on a sculpture, or whether they were, you know, presenting vials of their own vomit, or whether they were, you know, walking through Leeds shopping centre with their willies out painted blue, you know, performance. I'm slightly disdainful of this, but...
Slightly?
Slightly. Am I really disdainful of it? Anyway, so all these writers stress the contingent and social nature of these practices, that structure and social relations had primacy over individual consciousness, and that the subject, you know, so important to the Romanticists, is not some metalinguistic substance or identity, some pure cogito or self-presence, as the Romanticists would have it. Everything we did was always inscribed in language and social practice. I should briefly say, in case you think that, you know, the Romanticists had gone from art colleges then, I mean, I read that places like Richard Hamilton had, wherever he was, at Newcastle, he'd sort of tried to chase the self-expressionist model of teaching out of it, whether he did or he didn't, I don't know. But it was certainly, you know, totally alive at Leeds. It hadn't been thought about, challenged, or anything. And so, you know, it got to Foucault, was arguing that human feeling, as well as reason, is historically and contingently constructed. You know, I did tons of Derrida, who I did a record about, and subsequently met him and spent time with him at his house. By the way, Althusser, Althusser's writing about beliefs, desires, and preferences and judgments are all a product of social practices. Wittgenstein's private language argument, it all was so. I'm all opposed to the idea of art as a kind of pure truth, as having, you know, access to a special unmediated knowledge, an intuitive knowledge, which is what the Romanticists believe, having a pure self-presence, a pure self. Authenticating truth, you know, as a kind of a language, a means of communication removed from the crass contingencies of use or meaning. That was the... So I struggled largely alone to understand all those abstruse writings, and I'm sure I had a very elementary and imperfect grasp of most of them, but I persevered. How am I doing time-wise?
How 10 minutes.
10 minutes left or gone?
Well, you can have 10 minutes left.
Oh, okay. So, all right.
10 minutes gone, 10 minutes left.
Okay, I'll try and get through this quickly if it's of any interest. So I can't remember specifically how or when, but I made contact with members of the art and language group. And through that, I tried to set up an alternative teaching space or practice. And that were, and with their help, they sent somebody along who'd studied at Coventry, I think it was, to kind of help. What we did was to hire, I'm not sure how many times we did it, but it was a big deal. I would rent space above pubs in Leeds and invite people to come and talk. And initially, I don't know how many there were, it went from being a handful of students to, at the end, everybody, the head of Sir Patrick Nutchins, who was the head of the Polytechnic, the entire staff, everybody else, would come along to see what was being discussed there. And what was being discussed, the focus had become much more political, with focus on the status of art education and art education in Leeds in particular. There was, talk of folding the art department in with the design department. There were all sorts of... This was the beginnings of art education being in peril. And although I thought it was a terrible state of affairs at Leeds, it needed... fighting for, it needed defending, and it needed improving. And those became very... I interviewed Sir Patrick Nutchins. I contributed to an edition of Studio International called, I think, The Politics of Art Education. And I think the article was called, I don't have it, Show Us Your Uniqueness.
I have it.
Oh, you have it there.
Yeah.
Okay. And that was... it became a big deal, my attempt to challenge... that romantic idea of the solitary artist who was somehow in touch with the universe and could, you know, heroically provide everybody with access to some special unmediated truth. And so then, the struggles at the Polytechnic and the apathy of the staff, the disengagement of the students, it was the disinterest in ideas at Leeds, the lack of any critical involvement, and the difficulty for me of struggling in isolation were those... texts and those problems was pretty wearing, you know. And then the Clash, the Pistols, the Damned, and the Heartbreakers came to Leeds one night, And that was it. You know, everything changed. My whole... it's very difficult to describe. Were you there? Yeah, you might be. I think you're more eloquent about... I think I've read something you said about this. You're much more eloquent about that night than I am, aren't you? Undoubtedly you are. So I'm going to leave Kevin to talk about that night.
But it was... is that yours?
It's yours.
Okay.
It was... momentous. It's difficult without slipping back into romanticist language to talk about the impact of that night.
So then, I'm waffling a bit here, but stick with me. Okay. So it's hard enough to get a handle on what the counterculture was. The key things here, that one thing we haven't mentioned, we've talked about the post-war consensus, post-war settlement, which is hugely important to what we're talking about today, as is, and it's a very mysterious thing, the post-war settlement. There really, you know, there is kind of no such thing. And the same thing would go for the counterculture, which I think was hugely important, but very difficult to comfortably say what it was.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's difficult to talk about romanticism as well. Anyway, so it's hard enough to get a handle on what the counterculture was, let alone account for the central, pivotal role that music played. I'm going back to before I went to... I basically wanted to go to art school because, you know, I figured art schools were an outpost of the counterculture when I was a teenager. And the fact that so many rock bands came from art schools in Britain, phenomenal number... kind of clinched the deal. But I'll have to accept that by some means, without using the term affect, the music of the 60s brought me an idea of the ideas of the counterculture and the experience of freedom, hope, pleasure, and creativity, and a sense of a capacity to transform the world. This is when I was really little, I had this sense. The psychoactive power of the engagement with music gave me the assured sense that the meanings and sensations of the world were not fixed. I genuinely felt that possibly even before I was a teenager. And that's not far from the ideas of decentered subjects liberated from fixed identities to become dispersed and multiple that I found in Foucault, Lacan and Deleuze. And contentiously, I could hear the utopian, redemptive and emancipatory in the pop music of the 60s. I had a very inchoate idea of the various elements, movements, the counterculture and its commitment to radical transformation, really, when I was very young. And then a boy came to my school when I was 14 who was a Marxist. His family were... the school needed a new groundskeeper, and this chap came from Kent, and he was a narcoleptic. And you used to sit in class and look out the window and watch this chap mowing the rugby pitch, and he would fall asleep. It was, and plough into the hedge at the end of the... Almost every time, you know, it was fantastic. Narcolepsy. Narcolepsy is really interesting. And at that time, amusing. His son, name of Neil Jinks, they were a communist party. So that's where I got my interest in Marxism from when I was 14 then. But just to say that... pop music was never simply simple or trite for me. It was always a challenge and a stimulus to thought, and it brought confrontation with the working-class Tory asceticism around me. My parents were unskilled, workers. There were no books in my house. There was no discussion in my house. And it's difficult to disentangle the way that the music brought the message of the counterculture from the transformative psychoactive effectiveness of the music itself. I'm getting there, don't worry. And I could sort of leap ahead to say that the roots of punk and DIY are definitely as much in the high point of democracy in the post-war years, in the post-war settlement, and in the libertarian demands of the 60s, the counterculture, as it is in the failure of both of those things. Mm-hmm. And I definitely had benefited from, the post-war settlement. I was, I did 11 plus, I had good healthcare, we had decent housing, and my parents could afford to buy a record player through which, a machine through which the means to challenge so many things came to me. As somebody said of punk, while it may no longer have been realistic to demand the impossible, in 1977, the memory of having envisioned the impossible remained palpable in terms of its relationship with the counterculture. And I don't know, I've got lots of stuff here about how theory, theory became, continued to be important to talk about DIY and post-punk. Should I like to do a little bit of that?
Yeah, just a little. Give us a flavour, and then we can
pick it up. I thought that the sound of post-punk, I thought that a music that disrupted the conventions of pop music, the conventional structure of song, linear, teleological, melody, harmony, and rhythm, was more in keeping with, or symptomatic of, or analogous to, or exemplary of, the ideas of Derrida, Lacan, Foucault, Deleuze. The idea of a world without essences, a world of unstable meanings, fractured subjects, and all that stuff. The schizophrenic rebellion against capitalism, the idea that sense was complicit with common sense and common sense was tied up with bourgeois ideology. This held sway with my extended bandmates. Squitty Polity were not just, we decided we weren't just the people who played in the band, we were, everybody who was lived with us lived in the, when we moved to London, as soon as I got out of Leeds and seen the Sex Pistols, we started squatting in London, and I met a lot of ex-Young Communist League people. And our record label was also our Young Communist League branch, and we all squatted and were very active in taking over a whole street in Camden collectively. We lived collectively, we had our men's group meetings. God. And I wish you could have been there. We made music as collectively as we could. And anybody, we would have meetings all the time, endless meetings in which we would discuss. Everything was up for discussion. Every kind of note we played, everything we thought we ought to do and shouldn't do. And the door was to this. Our squat was always open. So all the friends would come every day, and we would talk about theory, we'd talk about Marxism, we'd talk about everything, and whatever those ideas, we'd rehearse in the same room, and people were at liberty to tell me that whatever I was doing was, not a good idea, or that was a good idea. And this really, when we made our first record, it was very important we put the cost of making the record and how to get in touch with us and how to make your own record, distributing this information, the access to enable more and more people to do it themselves was very important. And so lots of people did start turning up at our squat. There'd be runaway public school boys who'd come and decide they wanted to live with us, and there'd be, Euro crusties that would turn up, anarchists from, I don't know, it was an extraordinary time. It was really very exciting. It was exhausting. And then I forged ties with Rough Trade Records, which is still my record label today, despite having gone away for a while. And that was that at that point was a cooperative, and everything was decided cooperatively. So we'd go from one lot of amphetamine fueled, alcohol fueled discussions in and around the squats over to Rough Trade Records, where the same kind of discussions would be going on about what records ought to be released, what sleeves ought to be like. It was very important. The anti-professionalism was very important. Am I running out of steam here?
Running out of time, but not running out of steam.
Okay. Well, have I kind of... I don't know what to say. I've got lots here to say about DIY, shall I shut up?
We could leave it there, and then we'll
thank you very much.
To it. Thank you very much. And what we will do, we will now hear from Kevin, and then we will open up a discussion about everything that we have heard. So, Kevin, if you'd like to take the hot seat.
How to follow that? I suppose I'll do it in a slightly different key because it's the same song.
Is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. I could just go ditto, and that would be a shorter version. Beneficiary of the state. I think that's a really interesting place to start. Really similar. South London for me instead of Newport. Working class parents, first one in the family to go to university. A grant when I was 11 to go to a minor public school in Kent that was a feeding thing for Oxbridge and all that. A very traditional, unpleasant, nasty place. But because it was the late 60s, wrapped up inside that, there was a wonderful liberalism as well. And so I was formed in the art department in that school. And everything that I since was came into being in a liberal enclave wrapped around by a vicious, hostile and foul conservative structure. And that's been my life ever since, really. And music, art and politics, that's the world I've lived in. I can hardly bring myself to say it, but the map that I've moved through. And that started then. And art was what I did, but music was what I was and what I felt. And in that art room, there was a record player. And that record player was on all day, every day. And me and my friends were in that art room at every possible opportunity. It was, you go to a lesson and then you'd be back there. And we were there in the evenings and we were there at the weekends. And we had a magnificent teacher, Bob White. And by the time we'd finished our A-levels and left, I knew all about the avant-garde. We did art history there. I'd done performance work, I'd done film, I'd done photography, I'd done silkscreen, I'd done painting, I'd done graphic design. So I was kind of well-equipped, unknowingly. You know, when you're that age, it's just around you. It just happens. I didn't know how exceptional that was. I was very lucky. And out of that art department came the Meat Ponds and the Gang of Four. We were all mates over two or three years in that, and we all came to Leeds. John from the Gang of Four was and myself were the first ones in 1974, and then the next year, Andy Gill from the Gang of Four and Mark White from the Mekons followed, and the year after that, Tom Greenhouse from the Mekons. So it was obviously a very important and formative experience. And also from that time, Adam Curtis and Paul Greengrass, all the art room, all that crowd. Something good was going on there in that very strange mix of liberalism wrapped around inside the iron fist of sort of vacuous Toryism. Why did I come to Leeds? I thought it was interesting. I mean, the Poly, the university, you describe them as being very different. Your description of your time there was absolutely identical to my experience, really? Except there was no testosterone-fueled braggadocio from the staff, but other than that, it was the same. But I came to Leeds because I wanted freedom. I didn't want any tuition. I was pretty, you know, pretty well versed in the avant-garde by then and in love with it, and I wanted to pursue that, and I wanted a studio, and I wanted to be left alone, and I wanted some kind of input. So I went to a university for the art history, which was consistently disappointing all the way through. I learned far more from my teacher at the art room in Seven Oaks School than I ever did of any use or value from the art history department at Leeds University. I should point out, because I don't want to do a disservice to Tim Clark and Terry and Griselda, they came halfway through my time there. I had 4 years to mess about. They came halfway through, by which time I was fairly settled in what I was doing. Before that, it was I think both institutions had the same thing, that they had a pretty good run and the wind had gone out of their sails. I mean, the reputation of the Poly was stunning. And I only discovered the other day, considering I was very interested in film at the time, that the art department at Leeds had a film component to it in the late 60s and early 70s that was highly respected. Mm. The only sign I saw of it was I did Goddard for my dissertation, and I was able to watch some Goddard films on my own on a viewer editor in a room that was the only time I ever saw it opened in the art department, and it was full of film editing equipment. That was the only time. So it had fallen on... It was in the doldrums. The staff were worn out. They hadn't really got anything to say or contribute, which was fine by me. I didn't want it. I would have... it's a shame we didn't know each other better then, because I would have really enjoyed those conversations that you were wanting to have. But they weren't really available. But I did have some mates as well, as I've explained, so we kind of had the conversations ourselves. Anyway, good, we've got some slides going on up here because I wanted to talk about that. So, it was a strange time. It was a doldrums politically, winter of discontent and the Labour government falling to bits, and I think creatively it was the doldrums as well. We hadn't yet seen the eruption of creative energy that was kind of kicked into being by Thatcher and her works. And so I came to that place full of enthusiasm for the avant-garde and full of a love for music, and became politicised really quite quickly and began to struggle with the dissonance between political radicalism and aesthetic radicalism, and I found it extremely uncomfortable, and I couldn't find any way of drawing those two things together. And I started doing quite a bit of photographic pieces and performance pieces, and this is a performance piece that I did, and interestingly, it was a collaboration with people from the Poly, Raz, do you remember Robert Joyce?
Yeah.
And Joe Barnett?
Yeah.
And a couple of other people from my course, Ramsey Birch, who you may know.
Yeah, he's a scholar.
An academic in... modern dance. He was at the uni, and we did a performance piece called The Dignity of Labour. And I'll just read to you. I found all sorts of stuff I didn't know I had. In my final degree show, I did a documentation of some of the stuff that I'd done and put up little pieces of writing. So this is what I wrote about this piece. This is in response to the strange notion that the quality of a work of art, I've got a glass in there, is somehow related to the amount of work spent on it. So we worked ourselves to the point of exhaustion, doing press-ups, running backwards and forwards, and jumping on and off a chair. Then we showed tapes of this whilst humping around a monitor till exhausted and climbing up and down a ladder till likewise, and finally covering up our manhandled monitor with sand, a handful at a time. So we've moved on now, so leave that there for a minute, if you will. So what was that about? That was about that isolation, that loneliness, that complete lack of ability to find an audience and to engage with any audience you could engage with, and to get any kind of sense of purpose and worth from the work, and also trying to deal with some of the fallacious notions around what art was or wasn't, was all wrapped up in that piece. And we did it in a public space. It was the University Union coffee bar. And there's some more of it. And there's one earlier on of us shifting this extremely heavy monitor, and a guy sitting in the background just kind of looking. And that was about the best you could hope for. In terms of an audience, somebody kind of looking. And after that piece...
when was this?
This is in 76, that piece. Okay. I tried a few more public performance pieces in various parts of the university and was still struggling with this issue of why am I doing this stuff? Who is engaging in it? The loneliness for me came there in that there was no audience, and there were some serious problems about why there was no audience, and it was about where the avant-garde had got itself at that point. It was extremely elitist, extremely obscure and ephemeral, and very, very hard for anybody to engage with unless they'd gone through a whole transformation of their way of understanding art. And it felt like pretty much a dead end. So then I started trying to do work that directly stepped right outside of that, and that was that coloured piece up there. Here. So I started trying to just go out to people. So I changed my style, made it silly and funny and not arty at all, but I mean, I'm asking people, do you want to join in and do some art? Let's do some art together. Unsurprisingly, it was an utter failure. Nobody was the slightest bit interested in the art that I wanted them to do, and I did four or five pieces like this, put them up in galleries, I stapled them around the university, I put them up on lampposts in the streets, and I got back graffiti and stupid jokes and posters slashed and nothing. Nothing at all. What a surprise. But I tried. And I tried one other thing as well, and this relates to something you don't know is happening when it's happening, especially when you're young, which is the milieu. So one of the reasons why Leeds was a fruitful place, apart from being a hard, difficult place, with flinty ground, let's say, was that it was it had a long radical tradition, which I was completely unaware of. I don't know if you knew anything about it at the time. And there was a free school there. There was a radical paper called the Leeds Other Paper. And there was a whole food co-op called Summer. And the cooperative movement was very strong in Leeds, only just over the hill from where it all started.
That was very influential, actually, come to think of it. What the hippies were doing in Leeds. I mean, what we didn't like was the New Ageism and the mysticism. Mm. But a lot of the rest that they were up to was really good and influential stuff.
Yeah, the housing co-ops.
The housing co-ops, the things that they printed, the mimeographed, whatever it was. There was tons of stuff going on. Yeah. That was actually informative.
You just kind of breathed it in. You didn't even realise that there was anything in particular about that. And one of my last kind of flailing attempts at trying to do some art, I decided to make a documentary about Summa, the Whole Food Co-op, but I wanted to make it in an avant-garde manner. So I wanted it to be radical in its form, as I thought befitted a radical project. And I tried for about 6 months to do it. I think I shot off about 3 minutes of Super 8 film with some cabbages in a field. And I couldn't do it.
Did he bring it?
I did look for it. I can't find it. But I was just beyond me. It was impossible. I couldn't. And that kind of summed up that problem, that you had radical politics and you had radical art. Oh, and the people who are involved in radical politics. Oh. The music they liked, the clothes they wore. It was appalling. So there was... It was really impossible to find a way to join those two together. So there was music and art on one side, which was exciting and wonderful, but the art was in a dead end and the music was produced by people up on high stages that you could never even think about being engaged in. And the politicos were thoroughly earnest and completely tedious and had no joie de anything. So there I was, grinding down steadily to zero, overwhelmed by the issues of the elitism, the obscurantism, the incomprehensibility of the avant-garde, and its utter failure to engage with radical politics, which were so important at that time. I mean, you know, as Green was saying, before you had a cup of tea in the morning, you had to discuss how you were going to have that cup of tea and what was the appropriate way to have that cup of tea. Well, in fact, you shouldn't be having tea at all. Because it was and utterly exhausting, and I don't know where it got us, but it was the air we breathed and the way that we were. And then, in this state of extreme frustration, completely stuck in a dead end, came punk. Mm. And it was like, oh, that's the answer. It was just like you said, it was just like that.
Yeah.
It was, and that show, I had a slightly askance response to it, but I can't deny
it. It was the anarchy in the UK.
The anarchy in the UK.
Show at the Poly in December 1976. Yeah.
And suddenly, there were people engaged in creative production who were just like me. And they had an audience. Never mind that the audience hated them. They had an audience, and there was something happening that was visceral, but also had overtones that you could relate to at least in a kind of thinking way. And the idea that you could, that this music, which was crude, and you could work out how to make it pretty quickly, which is one of the things I was beginning to want to do with avant-garde art. I really, really wanted to find ways to make things that were easy and quick and people could understand quickly and they could do themselves, and that whole DIY to do. It was all there. It was just, oh, right. And I can remember turning to Mark of the Mekons doing that gig and saying, well, we can do this. Let's just do it. And so we just did it. That was another attempt at, these are things I stuck up round everywhere and trying to get people to join in. And this was an art kit that I offered to anybody who wanted it. They can go and make some art, and it had bits of collage stuff in it and what attributes you needed to be an artist and what art was. Nobody was interested. But there I was, and that was the advert for it. And then, can you pause on that for a minute? And then the Mekons happened. Thank you very much. That's just bang on. So it's a gang of art students, in a way, living out a little fantasy of, oh yeah, rock bands come from art school, don't they? Ooh, that's nice. Ooh, and we are. But we did it in a very art student-y way, and it was more of a performance at first, and we really couldn't very much play our instruments, certainly the very, very first incarnation of the Mekons. Mark played a bass guitar. He'd never played one before. He used a house key as a plectrum. Andy Gill from the Gang of Four played the drums. He'd never played drums before. I played the guitar, and I think I knew two chords, and not very well. And we wrote the set lists out wrong so that everyone was doing a different song at the same time, because they're all in different order. And it's true, yes, we did get Sofa on stage and call it Spaceship, and it was approached from that, well, we're artists and we'll use this lovely opening that punk has created to do the kind of art that we were trying to do but couldn't do, but now we'll do it in music. And so we wanted it to be, and again, you know, all this, the parallels are so strong. We were very keen on the DIY aspect of it. We really wanted everybody to do it at our early gigs. Anybody could come up at any time and join in, which was a really stupid idea, but we did it a lot. The number of terrible punk bands that we helped birth.
God, yes.
What a weight to carry on your shoulders. Was quite amazing. And this is an early publicity photo of the band. I don't think there's anyone of the band in that photo. That was kind of trying to deal with the cult of personality and taking even further that idea that you wanted the band to be as fuzzy-edged as possible and the boundaries between the band and the audience to be as permeable and as fluid as possible. And so that was, we were making a point. I mean, I think John's in there somewhere actually at the back, but But basically, that was a load of mates. We said, all crowd together, and we sent that out to the press. The band was a band. There were a set number of people in it, and it was quite stable for quite a while. And I think there's another photo there of the actual band. That is the actual band. It did exist. I'm holding the record.
Yeah,
the thin one. That's Mark, who came from the school with me. That's John, who's still very busy. Andy Corrigan, and then Tom, who came from my school, and Mary Jenner, who's now a classical violinist. So some good came out of it. I just can't get over how deeply parallel our experiences were. We ended up producing very different sorts of music, but the journeys that we went on, the experiences that we had, and the thoughts that we had are so similar. But there's one last thing I'd like to just... I'm nearly done.
Yeah.
Something happened at our time at the Poly and the University, which was a complete transformation. And as far as I'm concerned, it came about through music, which was that we all started to talk to each other. And that hadn't happened before. There'd been enmity and friction and competition between the Poly and the Uni. But at our time, that stopped. Mm. And we all became friends, and we all did projects together, and we all went to each other's gigs. And that all, to me, you might be different to you, all came about through music, because we all went to one nightclub in Leeds, the only nightclub on the Hedgerow in Leeds, the Heaven and Hell, on a Wednesday night, a student night. And I can remember the first, it was, I don't know why, but it was the Poly Art students and the Uni Art students who went there. And I can remember us all standing on different sides of the room, eyeing each other up.
Absolutely.
And slowly, slowly, over the weeks, we all got to know each other. So music ran through everything. So in some ways, it's no surprise when art was such a dead end that what you were became what you did. Because for a while, what I did wasn't what I was. Mm-hmm. It was art, and that wasn't working. And then finally, it was music. And so that getting to know each other at a disco on a Wednesday night was really, really important. I think many things wouldn't have happened, and they wouldn't have happened in the ways that they did happen if it wasn't for that. And there was a lot of interchange. And to me, it's interesting. I don't know what you thought about the university at the time, but I thought the Poly was much more interesting, much more exciting. People were doing all sorts of things, and I did lots of projects with people there. And as I said, that Dignity of Labour piece with Robert Joyce, or Raz as we knew him, he was very interesting, the stuff that he did, poetry, performance, all sorts. I did some male art with, I can't remember his name, I did some body casting with Joe Barnett. Lots of things were going off, and it was all easy, and it was all, to me at least, seemed a very natural thing to do.
Can we give Kevin a round of applause at this stage? Thank you for that, both of you, for those fascinating accounts, and sometimes converging, sometimes diverging accounts. Green, I wonder if I could open up by asking you for a response to some degree to what Kevin's just said, because what struck me as you were talking, it seemed like the reason why avant-garde art was, why it failed for you is because it didn't have a public, at least in Leeds. It didn't have an audience, whereas music most definitely had an audience. There were people that went to the Anarchy gig at the Poly, for example. Green, was that something of a concern to you? Was there a sense that art didn't have a public, didn't have a kind of crucial critical mass of people attached to it?
Yes, I'm sure that was a significant factor, as was the fact that, you know, me struggling with these texts in isolation and this abstruse work was kind of getting me nowhere. Because, I mean, when I finally did my final show, and I mean, it was just a fucking screed of writing round the wall. There was only one tutor who even attempted to read it, and Jeff Teasdale, his name was. And he read about, you know, it's on A4 sheets. He got to like sheet number 6, and he put a matchstick in to remind him to come back and read the rest. And he never did come back, and that matchstick remained part of my show, if you like. That was as far as anyone ever got in reading what I'd done. And that was exactly the time that the pistols came and the clash. And
because part of the reason why you went to music, why you looked towards music, that music had a capacity to transform the world, or certainly had a transformative capacity,
yeah,
was because it impacted upon many people's lives,
yeah,
right? I just find it so incredible that so many of you at the same time turned towards music when there is absolutely nothing of that going on in the context of where you're meant to be, you know, at the art school, making art and all the rest of it. I mean, did that feel like you were exiting the art school somehow to begin making music and getting into bands?
I think emotionally and intellectually I'd already left it,
right,
because it was dead in the water. And it was very, very, you were very isolated. Mm. If you go to the pub at night, which is what we all did all the time, you'd talk about music.
Mm.
You wouldn't talk about the art that you were making, maybe to one or two people for 5 minutes before you got too embarrassed and shut up. So music was the that's what I meant about what you were. It was the lifeblood. It was the way you met people, the way you understood people. And art was this dusty irrelevance that happened in silent rooms.
But some of the resources that you'd encountered at art school, theory in particular, were things that you both, it seems, carried with you in your thinking and discoursing around what you were both doing as musicians.
Mm. Yeah, I did very much so. I mean, it was when I'm just remembering that it seemed much in the way that, you know, the whatever that impetus was that started, if you like, with conceptual art, of examining the assumptions and the practices of art, we did pretty much went into music with the same attitude,
mm,
which was to, you know, question the assumptions behind really rock music, you,
yeah,
know, and there was a lot, there are a lot of romanticist ideas, there still are, astonishingly, in this day and age, about authenticity, truth, you know, a kind of self-presence, the role of the individual in rock music that we were very strongly against. We definitely, you know, stressed the collaborative,
yeah,
the social nature of it. It was very, very important to, and that theory was informed all of that, was useful. It was, you know, briefly, it's interesting that, you know, I wasn't above using the theory that I used against art, put it that way, at Leeds, both to defend what we were doing with DIY post-punk, and then to turn it on post-punk when I wanted to make pop music.
Mm.
You know, I mean, yeah. And it's difficult to be able to pick apart to what extent I used theory as a not as an apologia or you know, whatever, to account for the kind of music I wanted to make, and how much the theory informed the choices about what music I wanted to make. You can't really disentangle mm. those things. But yes, theory was alive and central to, and collectivism was alive and central to all of that. Everything that happened in the squatting in Camden hinged around, the squats, the Rough Trade Records, in a bookshop called Compendium Books, which is where we got access to all the ideas, you know, that were.
It'll be interesting to ask maybe Colette and others later as to whether or not that kind of fertile meeting of theory and music making still persists today. Because when I'm minded of Viv Albertine, when she came to Goldsmiths recently and did a talk, some popular music student asked her, if you were starting out today and making music, what kind of music would you make? And she said, I wouldn't make music,
mm.
because music is no longer the site of kind of cutting edge cultural production any longer. I wondered what you both thought of that, and then we'll open up.
I completely agree with her.
Mm-hmm. Do you? I don't.
Yeah. No.
Play out your disagreement.
I think the DIY now is ubiquitous. I think, I get free access to all sorts of music every day of my life that I find fascinating and challenging. And I think there is still, in the business of engaging with music, there is still the transformative potential that there was that I found in listening to music as a teenager in the 60s. I don't find it denuded of power in any way whatsoever, and I find that collaborative spirit and a DIY spirit is thriving, alive and well, and I feel very positive about it. And I would, if I were 17 now, I'd start a band, no question.
Personally. Kevin?
If it was me being 17 now, the me that I am is formed by all that happened behind me, I would, but I think if I was not me being 17 now, I wouldn't.
Okay, I'm not quite sure I understand. But.
Well, but I can't take myself out of me and say what a 17-year-old me would be. And music was so deeply important for me, I can't take that out of me.
All right, it remains deeply important to me.
Yeah, and it does to me, but that's because of who I was and what I've lived through. But I think if I was talking to somebody now, I would say I can't see why you would do
really?
That.
That's fascinating. I completely disagree.
I think there's many, many other forms of activity, possibly not art even, that would be much more interesting to be engaged in. And the landscape is so utterly different. And I think that's the point I'm trying to make. The landscape shaped us and...
Well, I wouldn't think that making music would be, exclusive of other forms of engagement, other new formations, new ideas, all of which are desperately needed at the moment, at no other time in my life. We need to be thinking collectively, we need to be thinking oppositionally, we need to be organising it really is desperate that we do. Mm. But I wouldn't, I'd see making music, for me at least, as I still make it every day, as an important... it's still a vibrant
thing. A lot of the DIYers that I see now, and Leeds is vibrant as it was, work across the field in ways that we kind of touched on, but much more thoroughly. So they might be working in web design or print or food, and they'll be doing music.
Yeah,
and,
that's true.
And
that's
I think true. That would be that's a much more interesting way of working now.
Yeah, no, that's definitely the
well,
case.
Well, we will definitely return to that issue in a couple of hours' time. Now it's time to embrace our own fuzzy permeability between this group this group here sitting at the front and you lot. It's time to hear some of your voices. Who would like to ask or make a comment? We've got a microphone, so if you could just wait for it to come to you, because of the broadcast.
Female voice.
Yes.
Yes.
I've got a slightly different chronology and sense of chronology to the one you have, and particularly in where theory comes in to the kind of raw politics which I felt was there. Particularly the Vietnam War coming to an end in 73. Mm-hmm. And the effect that had. I did a thesis at the Royal College on the future of art education 71 to 73 on Beuys in Düsseldorf, Art Language in Coventry, and Nova Scotia College of Art and Design as the three models, I thought, for the future. And all three were shut down by the time I came to hand in 73. And there was this kind of complete sort of backlash. I'd founded the bookshop at the ICA, and I had very little. I mean, I did bring in copies of Tel Kel from France, but I didn't really have a sense of the theorists that you're talking about. That kind of comes late 70s?
Oh, yeah. No, by the time...
And into the 80s?
The French.
Not in the middle 70s.
Yeah. No, a lot of the fights that I had at Leeds, I used analytical philosophers to bat away romanticist ideas. Do you know what I mean?
And this is where Terry Atkinson, and particularly, and some of the students around art
did you
and
know?
Language.
I mean, I didn't know any. Well, I kind of did later. I didn't know.
Well, he taught me in Canterbury in the late 60s. And Canterbury was totally dominated by Leeds people. Tom Watt, Stas Brascos were all teaching down there. Uh-huh. And Terry was coming in at that time. But that was a long time before. But it's that way in which post-Vietnam, there was a sort of American push on French theory, which, you know, when you look at 68 and all the riots that were taking place across Europe, the way in which Paris lost any kind of political connection, it was just students rioting kind of thing, as opposed to it being an anti-Vietnam demonstration. We lost any sense that the Rolling Stones were in Grosvenor Square and went home and wrote Street Fighting Man, you know, and these sort of things that were really important, 68, 69.
I think that I really like that point that you made about closure happening as the 70s went on, and that echoes what we were saying about that, well, I call it a doldrums. It was like great, great things had happened, and we were just too young for them, and when it came to our turn, it was like...
It was a bit like arriving at a party after everyone had got too drunk and the most interesting people had left.
Yeah. Me and quite a lot of my contemporaries had this feeling that there had been a deliberate American campaign to bring in theory. You know, if you look at October, the founding of October magazine, nothing could be more right-wing, and yet it called itself October.
When you say theory, what... I mean, I don't know that.
Well, Derrida and
oh, that was an American conspiracy?
Well, the publication of it and translation of all that material into English comes largely through the States.
Okay.
And so one had seen that as a way of distracting us from the political position post-Vietnam.
I understand why, you know, as many...
I might be wrong, but...
Well, no, you know, many people point to that moment where a lack of political engagement, everybody seemed to be interested in deconstruction, and no one was interested in the no-bullshit option of doing politics anymore. Mm. And how accurate that analysis is, I don't know. I think there were lots of other reasons for the failures of the left at that time, and I certainly wouldn't think that theory was kind of responsible for political malaise. I mean, before then we had Althusser, of course, who was a big, you know, had come from that sort of before the Derridians and the rest of it, and his impact was important to.
The Second World War is a particular point, and it's much more out of a German context.
Yeah.
Which I'm not talking about. I'm
okay.
Talking about the way in which France was raised. Above German philosophy, and you know, going to Germany in 69, you know, and that sense of shame about the Second World War, which was so dominant and was the sort of thing that created the whole Conrad Fischer Düsseldorf phenomena of conceptuality in Europe.
We'll have to leave that point there. I just want to get some any other questions, Donna. If any of other people have got questions, can you just show me your hands? If not.
I feel like I've got a burning question, which is why I've stuck my hand up quickly, which is just the last point that you were discussing just now around the role of music now as opposed to then, and you know the differences in your different sort of perceptions of it. And I'm completely agree with what you're saying about the amazing music that's being made now, and the energy around it is really exciting and really interesting and inspiring. And I guess the main difference, and one of the things that I was just thinking when you were talking throughout, you know, what you've both been saying, is how punk in particular just went immediately mainstream in the way that the kind of music that's being made now, which is as relevant and interesting, is not mainstream. It's sort of underground and hidden, and you have to kind of seek it out. And maybe it would be interesting to hear more about the wider political conditions that allowed music like that to make such a mainstream impact so quickly, as opposed to the role of music now, which you know, sort of more edgy music is more underground, and you have to go, you have to seek it out mainly in art spaces, actually.
Well, I would suggest you have to take account of the internet, really, to understand why there are so many. I mean, we've moved from a culture of, which was the 70s and 80s, a culture of broadcasting to a culture of narrowcasting, really. So, yes, you're right, you have to kind of know where to find somebody on the internet. Whereas if you manage to get onto Top of the Pops in the 70s and 80s, you know, but everybody knew.
But why was it embraced by the mainstream audience?
Why was punk embraced?
Yes. So what were the political conditions? But it went straight into Top of the Pops, the Sex Pistols. You know,
that's not how I remember it. I would say that 90% of punk was obscure, and you had to search it out, and it didn't get any airing, and it was harder then because there was like a couple of music papers to read and John Peel, and that was about it. There were, I mean, it took a while, and then it broke. But only a few bands.
I mean, after the hoo-ha about the Pistols, and I mean that aspect of punk was over very quickly. I mean, we lost interest in that aspect within a year, I think. And the whole post-punk thing, the DIY thing, really kicked in then. And there were thousands of people engaged creatively up and down the land because of the possibility of DIY records. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of them. Who, without that, I don't think would have had any kind of possibly creative engagement at all. I mean, it enabled people in every little town and village in the country for some people to get together to make their own sleeves, to make their own records. I mean, hundreds of them largely forgotten. But for a moment there, it was intensely, you know, participatory, emancipatory, and creative. And I think that's undeniable, regardless of who was on Top of the Pops. That's my take on it.
I would like to ask the organisers, do we have a break between session one and session two?
Not, I think, do we? I think we need one, don't we?
Yeah.
Everyone's holding.
I mean, I've got another question to ask, but we've not got time for that. So, have we? Have we?
We have a break after the second session.
Okay.
So we can make a
little 5 minutes.
5 minutes.
Thing.
Yeah.
Should we decide collectively to have a 5 minute break?
Yeah. But before we do that, can I just ask one quick question, which is basically about the importance of autodidacticism.
Yeah.
Because you both kind of circled around it in various different ways. And, you know, since the Wysing Poly thing is all about education and methods of learning and all the rest of it, I mean, can you just say just very, very briefly why you think autodidacticism was such an important feature of the way you learned? I mean, you talked in particular about that, Green. I mean, art and language were autodidactic.
Yeah,
autodidacts as well. They read philosophy themselves within the collective.
Yeah. Well, I guess you had to do it because there was nowhere else to go get it. Do you know what I mean? Subsequently, there, you know, academically, you can study just about any aspect of what we did. Do you know what I mean? There are courses now in God knows what kind of, you know, post-punk composition. You can find a college somewhere in America that'll teach you that and throw the theory in for free, you know. But at my time, there was nothing and nowhere and no one. So if you had questions, you had to get together with, you know, if you could find them, like-minded people, and get yourself down to the library and struggle with these texts. That was...
Yeah,
just with reference to that and the relationship between what we thought of you at the university, I think those of us at the Poly, people like me envied what we imagined was a much more informed and enlightened series of, well, I kind of fantasised that was going on where you were, that, you know, you were actually talking about you these things in a way. I mean, I went to one art history lecture at Leeds Poly, and it was so appalling. I never went back in the 3 years I was there. So, and there was nowhere, you know. But I guess I thought you guys probably had it good in that respect.
We used to go and sit in the very back of the lecture theatre, and there would be a as we all opened a can of beer.
Okay.
And drink the beer and go to sleep.
All right. It was a fantasy then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, time not...
It changed.
Time not for beer, but for coffee or something. Our second session, entitled Ensemble Creation Between Then and Now, and I'm joined by Claire MacDonald and Chris Good. Claire was one of the founder members of Impact Theatre, which has a connection with our earlier session. Impact was founded in Leeds in the early 80s, or was
late,
it late,
late
70s?
Very late 70s, but, yeah.
Very late 70s. And so has some kind of overlap with the social and the creative milieu that you've already heard about, and was an outfit that was experimental in terms of its form, and that theatrical form was the result of an ensemble production process. Decisions were made collectively. There wasn't a strong directorial hand, as I understand it, although people had different jobs to do. But decisions were, the group met and made decisions about collectively about which way to go. Today, we might say, Impact Theatre is and was devised. Although I know you're not particularly happy with that word, Claire, as a description of Impact's process. And we've also got Chris Good from Chris Good and Company, who is the director of the contemporary performance ensemble, Ponyboy Curtis, which some of you may have been lucky enough to see recently in performances at the Yard Theatre in Hackney Wick. So both of our contributors have been involved in ensemble work. It may have ensemble work in theatre may have interesting parallels with what we might wrongly call ensemble work in music production, in bands. There may be in for example, the discussions that Kevin and Green were talking about that took place, in the rehearsal studio, and the arguments that took place about, that kind of mixing of argument and doing, that kind of poesis, if you like, is I think relevant to the production of music as it is to the production of performance and theatre. Just to say, while we're on theatre, that the title of today's session, Collective Creation Between Welfare and Austerity, I shamelessly nicked from theatre scholarship, and there's these two volumes. One's called A History of Collective Creation, the other is Collective Creation in Contemporary Performance, both edited volumes by Catherine Sisayeva and also Scott Proudfit, if you want to chase them up. But just to more fully introduce our contributors, Claire will be speaking first, Claire MacDonald, and she works in the arts and centres on conversation, collaboration and community. She writes and teaches widely and was a co-founder, as I've already mentioned, of the influential visual theatre-making collective Impact Theatre Cooperative in Leeds, whose archive of film and performance is now being reworked by the company, starting with the showing of the film version of The Carrier Frequency, a collaboration with the writer Russell Hoban at Arts Admin in London earlier this year. Her recent book, Utopia, is both a collection of plays and a reflection on the cultural history of her practice. Her recent writing also includes All Together Now, Performance and Collaboration, which is a fantastic essay that I use a lot in my teaching and also in the book I'm writing, and that can be found in Dee Hedden and Jenny Klein's collection called Histories and Practices of Live Art, which was published by Palgrave in 2012. She also writes on poetics, feminist art practice, and the pedagogy of performance writing. She's currently a senior research fellow at Central School of Speech and Drama in London. Claire will be then followed by Chris Good, who is a writer, director, performer and musician. He has been lead artist of Chris Good and Company since its inception in 2011. He is also director of the performance ensemble, as I've said, Pony Boy Curtis. Recent work for Chris Good and Company includes Wanted, which is at the West Yorkshire Playhouse, Everyone, Battersea Arts Centre, Weaklings, Warwick Arts Centre, Men in the Cities, Royal Court and Traverse, Stand, Oxford Playhouse, Forest in the Field, Oval House, and The Adventures of Wound Man and Shirley, again at Battersea. Chris is the author of The Forest and the Field, Changing Theatre in a Changing World, which was published by Oberon, and he hosts the Chris Good and Company podcast, Thompson's Live. Let's welcome our contributors. Claire, if you please.
I'm going to use this mic because it's a lot easier for me to stand up and talk to you. And Liam is going to run a short piece of a video of a very old show of mine. And we'll see which one it is when it comes up. In fact, it's an absolute privilege to be here and extraordinary to follow Green, who I didn't know at Leeds, and Kevin, who I knew very well in 76, 77. I'm going to start by just saying a couple of things about that moment in Leeds. A story, if you like. And the story I tell you today will be different from any other story that I might ever tell any of you on any other day, because we are here together, and the people who are here and the things that are said are different from any other time that we might be together now, then, or in future. So in 76, 77, just before that night that Green and Kevin talked about, I met Kevin. We encountered one another in that space just before everything happened. And it happened differently for each of us. My own encounter with Leeds went right back to 71. When I was 16, I left school, I worked in a shop in Leeds, I did one A-level, and eventually, actually rather quickly, I went to university. I went to Leeds because, just as for Green, it was a kind of mecca. It was a big city, it was extraordinary. I'd been told by our art teacher that it was an amazing art school, but I just left school anyway, as many people did then, and then the rest of my life took off after that. But in 76, 77, things really began to shift. They began to shift for many people in profoundly different ways. I just left university, and I was also involved in the food co-op movement. But in 76, 77, I became involved in radical feminism. And that's one of the ways in which our lives began to fork very differently. That was a very different moment in Leeds for women. It was the moment of the Ripper case, which many of you will remember. It was a moment when, for us, the moment of punk was deeply fractured because it represented all kinds of things about anarchic voices in the public media, about a kind of infraction into the very alternative life that we lived, which was actually disruptive and finally, I think, fantastically refreshing, but also very difficult. After that moment, I moved into making a theatre cooperative, and the rest, as they say, is history, and somewhere it will be on there as well. I want to kind of break that moment, if you like, of nostalgic reflection, because I could really talk about it today, but won't. Kevin just said to me earlier in the taxi as we came here that it's like being in a long feedback loop. A kind of systems feedback that seems and yet doesn't quite seem to come back to a similar moment of today. The changing constant, or the constant changing. I've been thinking about it now ever since Gavin invited me into this conversation. What it is to be part of the changing constant, the constant change, as art is always part of. The continuously unfolding horizon of the present. And how does the past figure in that? How does the past continue to resonate in the present? So I'm here today to take part in a conversation with you, who are equally as qualified as I, to talk about past, present, then, and now. And I'm here because my own career connects moments of collective, cooperative spirit from the 1980s to the collaborative commons, the movement, the change, the uncertainty, if you like, of the present. To think about how to open up the present to the past usefully, and think about the kinds of tools that we need to do that. As you can see, I'm speaking to you from some roughly scribbled notes. They're evidence of my earlier thinking this week, and yet I've been thinking about this for a very long time, about how we converse, how we speak, what place we speak in, what voices can emerge in that space, what happens in the public square in order to somehow to invoke the possible. It's not easy in some way. What was then is not the then now. What was now then is not the now of then. And it's our job today, in some fantastic way, to be able to ask those places to begin to meet. Whenever I'm thinking about those terms, and I just used several, commons, collective, uncertainty, I think always about Raymond Williams. And most of you will be familiar with his extraordinary work, Keywords. And he began to put together a kind of index of words that were in flux, in continuous change, words that hurt, words that made people feel very uncomfortable, words that were in movement out of their own moment and into something else. And he began that when he was teaching an adult education in the 1950s. And he began it because when he returned to Cambridge after the war and came as a working class student on what I suppose in America would be called the GI Bill, he turned to a friend very famously and said, "But they don't speak our language anymore." So it was in response to his own experience. I wanted to say to you that I feel that I've moved from a moment in which words like proletariat, community, and co-op, gaze, and collective moved through edge, live, risk, and queer, and critical. They moved into the creative industries, into fluidity, into partnership. And as we speak, I think they've come to momentarily rest in local, in movement, in belonging, in transition, transparent, and transform. Let me tell you a story. And it's a story that some of you may have heard before, because it happened to me about 10 years ago, and it was picked up by Radio 4 and went on to Wireless Nights, which Neil McCarthy edited. But it was a story about something that happened to me when I was still living in America, so it must be before 2006. And I had come back, it was Christmas, and I'd come back to London to go and see my sister, who lives in Lewisham. And it was a very, very busy pre-Christmas afternoon. And I was at Charing Cross, and I went to get on the train. And the train was absolutely packed, and I could barely find a seat. But I found one, let's say it's here. And everybody was stuffed in around me, but there was a lot of space around one person. It's kind of around there, a little bit diagonally away from me. And it was kind of obvious what was happening there, because this space, this seat, was occupied by a rough sleeper, somebody who smelled and who looked really rough, who had a beard and very matted hair and a number of cans of beer, was white, probably around 40. And there he was with his little empire, and nobody sat next to him. And so the train moved off. And at the next station, at London Bridge, someone else got on. And by this point, there was no room to sit whatsoever. And this person was the diametric opposite of the rough sleeper, but he had to sit opposite him. And when he sat down with his parcels and his shopping, because it was before Christmas and these were gifts, he took out his mobile phone and he started to make a phone call. And as he started to make that phone call, the rough sleeper, at least I assume that's that he was homeless, leant over to him and listened. And yet, the mobile phone man, the smartly dressed man, was not speaking in English. He was speaking in what I presume was an African language. He was tall, good-looking, black, and wearing a very smart suit. And the sleeper looked over at him and he said, as the man put the mobile phone away, he said, "That's my language too." And the mobile phone man just kind of like went, "Yeah, okay, mate," you know, visually, and just didn't say anything. And he said, "My parents were missionaries in Africa. That's my first language." And the guy said absolutely nothing. We moved on the train, and it began to slow down at the next stop. And the guy with the mobile phone took up his smart bags, and he moved over to the door as the train began to pull into the station. And as he stood at the door, the other man spoke to him in the language they shared. And the moment he spoke to him in the language they shared, the mobile phone man put down his bags and he turned to him as the other man got up and they embraced. And their embrace was like brothers meeting after a war. It was like a mother meeting the child she hasn't seen for 50 years. They rubbed one another's arms, they laughed, they spoke in the language they shared. And within seconds it was over because the doors opened. No phone numbers were exchanged, nothing happened at all. One man got off the train, and the other man went back to his corner with his cans. And at the next station, Lewisham, where I got off, I could see him absolutely slumped in his corner. I barely need to say what I began to think about that afterwards, about the turn of things, about the way that colonialism and skin and class and what it means to have a home actually resonate in different ways in the present. But what I was absolutely aware of was that I had just witnessed what it means to be absolutely homeless. That story resonates with me continuously. But it's not the same story. In every moment that I repeat that story, it becomes a very different kind of story. At the moment when it happened to me, I had my own problems with refuge and immigration. No one else on the train noticed what was happening at all. They all continued with what they were doing. Today, in the moment in which we are, in July 2016, notions of what it means to belong, what it means to speak the same language, what it means to be local, are very, very different. So that the story that happened in just the kind of immediate past resonates in a very, very different kind of way. The German philosopher Ernst Bloch said in 1932 that we do not all live in the same now. We don't live in the same space. We don't live in the same present, but somehow we are called to share it. And the work that I've been involved with and was involved in the video you can't see, which is, I don't actually quite know what it is, but it doesn't matter. It's kind of a shadowy ghost, if you like. And somewhere there is a shadowy ghost of myself there 30 years ago as well. But the work that I've been involved in and was then was around trying to create, particularly at this point, in the late 70s and very, very early 80s, was about making work cooperatively that was in some way invoking possibilities that we could not express. We talked about it then as making work for other people with dreams without means. We were all very involved, as been mentioned earlier on, in all kinds of community action in Leeds. There was Leeds Other Paper, there were bands, there was Suma Food Co-op, which actually started in our local food co-op in our street in Hyde Park Terrace. There were all kinds of ways in which that world was very profoundly interconnected. It was also, as Green has suggested, at the kind of utter fag end of a romantic bohemianism that we enjoyed because we could be absolutely reckless with it. We didn't really ever think about the future or think that we had it. But strangely enough, and oddly it goes back to something that Terry from Wysing and I were talking about 10 minutes ago, one can never actually be very sure about the unintended consequences of what one does. Those unintended consequences, threads of connection that emerged from the values that we had then, continue to evolve and continue to resonate in the present that we have now. So that since I've since I'm not making collective and collaborative performance anymore, I've continued to both write about it. And much more than that, to have it as a kind of watchword, as value, within my own life and the way that I decided to live it. That's, in a way, one of the bits of conversation that I want to have. The process that we were involved in, and I'm going to bring in a very difficult word here, was actually, and I think Green talked about redemptive as well as transformative. And those are better words than spiritual. But there's also perhaps the imaginary that exists on the other side of what happens when you work together to have outcomes that you cannot possibly foresee. I think that that's a very interesting thing to be thinking about in uncertain times. Kevin and Green both talked about the ways in which we felt at the very end of the 1970s a profound disquiet about the certainties of left-wing politics. We felt absolutely sure that there were different ways of opening up the present and invoking almost prophetic ways in which the future might emerge. We could never have imagined the now then. But I also think we can't imagine the then now. The purpose of being here today to remember creatively in the sense of putting it together, almost as if it is a kind of, you know, loose organic body, is about actually useful ways in which the past can prompt us to think about the ways in which the values we hold to, and actually I think there must be many, many crossings of shared value in this room, that are also delivered and realized through multiple art projects. But that's the conversation. I want to end on the note conversation, because an ethicist, a philosopher in whom I'm very interested and have written about a bit, Kwame Anthony Appiah, talks about conversation as a much bigger word than the sense of being in a room and having a little dialogue. He talks about it in its 18th century sense of being about living together. And that the very notion of being able to converse, the very notion that we can be involved in a multifaceted way of exchanging together about our lives and lives that went before, about possible futures, about what we do. For me, that's one of the most useful dialogic tools that I learned from this extraordinary moment, which Kevin and Green evoked in a way which I found deeply moving and transformative myself. And I look forward to opening that conversation with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Claire.
Thank you for inviting me. It's a privilege.
Chris.
Hello. I'm going to speak, I think, much more prosaically than Claire just did. All I want to do, really, is introduce my work, because Gavin very kindly supposed that some of you might have seen it, but I'm going to suppose that none of you have. That feels like a more reliable point of embarkation for us. So I'll talk particularly about Pony Boy Curtis, which is the ensemble project that that I'm involved with currently. And I have a little sort of postscript, if I have time, just kind of thinking back towards some of the stuff that Green and Kevin were talking about before. So I started out as a playwright. I had my first, finished my first play and had my first professional production in 1994. And almost immediately I had a crisis about what it might mean to be a playwright. It felt like a very uncomfortable space to be in. For two reasons, I think, one of which is that I got into theatre because it felt like theatre was a social medium, and the individual model of the playwright, the romantic model of the playwright who sits in the garret and projects something out of the heavens onto a piece of paper, just felt utterly uncongenial and dull. So I started to worry about that. The other thing, the more interesting impetus, I suppose, at that point was noticing how inappropriate a container the script was for what I wanted to try and do, because right from the start I was much more influenced by music and by visual art and by experimental film than I was by other theatre and other performance that I was seeing. I was certainly in dialogue with, I suppose, artists like Derek Jarman or Michael Clarke or people like that. And the effect of that straight away was that my scripts looked incredibly unwieldy because they were mostly stage directions. I was trying to describe images and kinds of movement that it felt intrinsically ridiculous to try and be authoring as an individual. And so my practice took me straight away into the rehearsal room, into making work with performers and other creative people. I thought I'd sort of invented devising. I wasn't aware that anybody else worked like that. It was just, for me, an expeditious way of trying to make the work that I was interested in realising. And so we carried on in that way for a few years, and it became important to me quite quickly to have a company. Almost just as a sort of psychic landmark, having a company felt very important. And in 1999, I set up a company called Signal to Noise. The idea was that we would be a permanent collective. We started well. We started with a manifesto, as you must. And very quickly, things started to dwindle, mostly because of the economic pressures around the task of sustaining an ensemble, or carving out. I mean, none of us at that point were professional makers, so just trying to carve out some space in which to work together, or find physical space in which to work together. That's been a really ongoing narrative in my practice over the past 20-odd years. And so Signal to Noise, that ensemble that started with a group of seven of us in 1999, by 2002 I was doing my first solo show under that group name. That felt like that was the... there was some kind of... It was like there being a leak point in the inflatable. And within 3 years, that was all that we could support and muster. And in a sense, the rest of my career since then has been a sort of dialectical movement between the will to exist in an ensemble relationship with other makers and all of the pressures and forces that pull against that. In 2011, I started Chris Good & Company, which is really just a sort of structure, an administrative structure, a producing structure around the work that I was doing anyway as an independent artist. And Chris Good & Company still exists. We make three or four shows a year in a lot of different contexts and different ways. It's a group of three of us. So there's me and my producer and a critical writer, which is an unusual model. I'm not sure how prevalent it is, but that we have embedded right in the core of the company someone who writes critically about what we're doing. And that's been very interesting. But Chris Good & Company essentially is an idea in the form of a structure, and the structure is there to help me sustain my practice. And it was something that I've been struggling towards for 15 years by the time the conversation about it started. And almost immediately, again, I was very bored with what it made possible. That I found myself almost straight away in a position of having access through my producer to a more reliable funding streams, to being able to produce the work that I was interested in making. It didn't become easy, but it did become possible, and I immediately started hankering again for the sorts of impossible things that that keep us awake at night and drive us on. It had been, I think, an idea in my head from about 2003 that what I really wanted was an ensemble that worked more like a band. And in particular, an ensemble that would meet regularly to make work together regardless of whether it had the promise of an audience anyway down the line. That it would be something that we made for ourselves, that hopefully there would be outputs in front of audiences, but that we didn't care, that it became a practice that was for us, for our well-being, for our mental and emotional well-being. I don't mean that in a new agey, holistic-y sort of sense. I just mean we all know artists who go nuts if they can't do what they do. And that's we were just clinging together in that idea. It took 11 years from I think the first time I described that ensemble to the moment of pushing go on it. It was because it felt impossible. It felt like the economic conditions, the practical, the logistical challenges around trying to create that ensemble were insuperable. And I think I got to a point, this is sort of halfway through 2014, of realising it was never going to get any easier. Never, ever, ever. And that if it was ever going to happen, I would just have to start. And so Pony Boy Curtis, which is the name of that ensemble, started with a week of research in December 2014. And since that point, we've been in a constant making process, which has included the making of three shows, but they're, in a sense, the least of it. We do meet twice a week, and I guess we're the best possible example that I can think of in my own practice of an intuition that I had very early on, which is that as an individual artist, you only ever get to make particular artworks, particular shows, particular products. If you're a company, part of what you get to make is the company. And I feel like that's what we're invested in doing, is we get together to make stuff, and part of what we're making when we do that is the company that we make it with. I wanted a company with longevity beyond the normal cycles of making an individual piece. I wanted a conversation with some people that continued way beyond that, for two reasons in particular, one of which was that I have a long-standing interest in creating performance structures that are semi-improvised, so where interlocking structures of permission and prompt allow a group of performers to work together in a genuinely live and a genuinely spontaneous collective composition. So Gavin, for example, came to see a show we did recently at the Yard called Fuck Systems. If he had come, I don't know what night you came, Gavin, but if you'd come the night before or the night after, you'd have seen a different show. You'd have recognised the structure of it, the journey through it, but you'd have seen different things happen at every point. I'm very interested in that, but it's a kind of thing that's only possible in a group of people who know each other very well and who work with those techniques constantly. The other thing that's been a sort of impetus behind Ponyboy. And unfortunately, the images that I hope to show of our work haven't transmitted properly through the ether. But you'd be seeing some examples of this right now. I'm very interested, and particularly in the last sort of 7 or 8 years, sort of fixatedly interested on how theatre and performance do sex and eroticism. And so Ponyboy Curtis is a site in which we push. I hear myself say push sometimes and I worry about it, but we're nudging at the normative boundaries around performance practice in that kind of space. And that again obviously is a kind of ask for performers and for other creatives as well, actually, and for audiences. That requires a structure that's... oh, here we go. All right. That's sort of infused with the kind of trust and fealty and sort of tribal entanglement that only comes from long periods of working together on those edges These are images from a performance called Coyote that we did a few weeks ago. In fact, on the day after the referendum, which made it almost completely impossible to do anything. But that's what we did. So as far as I know, we're the first people ever put a blowjob on the stage of the new diorama. wear that with a certain amount of pride. When in Rome. I want to say two things really quickly, if I may. I'm sure. Over time. But I just want to say a little something about the economic conditions in which we work and the what the industrial situation is of Ponyboy, because we don't, on the whole, pay ourselves to do what we do. If we did, we couldn't do it. It's a very uneasy position, I think, certainly for me, to keep asking people to work for free. But on the whole, that's what we do. We fund ourselves through a variety of different channels. Our sort of hardcore research work here, hardcore as in it has no commercial appeal whatsoever. Research work is funded by the Arts Council, but our launch was funded by a crowdfunding campaign, and we now have some money on the table from a rich gay dude, almost inevitably. So we're having a conversation about how we feel about that. But on the whole, we don't pay each other, and that has two sort of interesting consequences, but interesting insofar as they shape the work. So one thing is that everybody tries to get together twice a week, but we say that if you have a job, a gig, whatever, that clashes with a Ponyboy meeting, and that's going to help you pay your rent, then you should prioritise that. And that means that we never know who's going to show up. And sometimes it will just be me and one person or two people. And this constant shift in what the shape of the company is because of the economic pressures that keep pulling us away from the work, from the place of the work, has shaped what the work is. It's shaped what those relationships, how we look at those relationships and what the kinds of relationships are that we feel accepting of. The idea that you have to be there in order to be part of the conversation is much more unstable than I think it would be in the rest of my work. The other thing that I think it's important to say is that we have a situation now where we are paid when we need to be. So there's a little bit of money in the company, and people who need to be paid for the work that they do with the company can ask to be paid. Mm-hmm. And that's something that the company again then administers. And again, pretty obviously, that requires a certain kind of set of relationships to be at work in the work that makes it not only permissible but desirable that different people are paid different amounts at different times for doing the same work according to the need that they might be in the moment that they're doing it. It feels like a really important part of our ethos. The last thing I wanted to say was just to make a quick connection back to the last session. I was thinking about the sort of scrappy energy that Ponyboy represents, and the model that I always reach for is the one of being a band and wanting that kind of relationship with the work and with our audiences. But I've been really prompted to notice how much my sense of what we do is also shaped by the experience that I had particularly early on in my career from an involvement in the experimental poetry scene in London. So Jeff Nuttall, who Green spoke about as his tutor in Leeds. I got to meet on that scene towards the end of his life. He was certainly a formidable person. And that was a group of, that still is, a group of people who are absolutely fixated on a particular mode of production in which almost nobody has any interest. And the ferocity with which they pursue it has always been very, very inspiring to me. So the first theatre text that I had published was published by a tiny independent poetry publisher called Bark, and the only time I ever saw that chapbook on a bookshelf was at Compendium, shortly before it closed. And it feels important to sort of mention those connections, because I know we've got a kind of a now and then thing going on, and it feels really important that there was also a middle ground where those things were, you know, were giving way to new things. And my attachment to the kind of scene that that was around, that was kind of in its, that was maybe just unravelling, that was that had stubbornly persisted through to the end of the 80s or the beginning of the 90s. My attachment to those residual parts of the scene feels like a place where I learned a lot to do a lot of the things that I now do, for example, with Pony Boy. I think I'm done. I think that's it. Thank you.
Fantastically rich, and I'm not going to say very much because I want to get other people's voices in, but I do want to kind of take some of the things that you were saying there about the scrappy energy, was that the phrase you used, of being in a band, and so also some of the economic pressures that impose upon being in an ensemble, and ask Claire to say a little bit about that, because I should say that part of my book is on impact theatre. So I've interviewed a number of its founding members, and Tyrone Huggins, another member of Impact from the time, recalls being in Impact as being feeling like basically living out of each other's pockets, which is a kind of economic rationalisation of the group, if you will. And I wonder if you could just say a little bit about that, Claire, about how you sustained the practice of impact, especially in the very early years.
I think many of the things that Chris and other people have said, of course, absolutely resonate with me. So being in a band, I think, is one of those kind of cultural icons that we all understand. And I think that sense of being bound together, having a sense of doing things as a kind of collective authorship that wasn't about one person and was about much more than we could make, was absolutely true. There was also a lot of crossover with bands as well. So Steve Shill was in Sheenie and the Goys, and Hugo Burnham, who's in the Gunner Four, was in Impact at the beginning, and then worked with Pete Brooks, the director of Impact, much later as well. So I think this is a very sort of interpolated kind of culture. How we sustained that, and I'm listening to Chris and thinking how many things are very common, even to that moment between the late 70s and the 80s, and things are changing all the time. I don't think there was a kind of... I'm not sure about the persistence of a scene or a culture. I just think it's constantly shifting and changing. How did we sustain it? Well, I think, first of all, we sustained it because I think there wasn't a sense of future. I think there was a sense of only being now. I don't think there was a future that we could have imagined. We all always worked at other jobs. I think there was, and it's been described earlier on today, a sort of imaginative seriousness about what we did, because I think the one thing that's perhaps changed very much in the culture and perhaps worth really talking about is whose voices are allowed to be, are really kind of enabled within the culture. So I think that in the sense there was a big alternative culture that was enabling many, many voices to be part of it then. You mean financially, though, economically?
Yeah, I do, yes.
Well, a couple of really big things. I think we were absolutely a collaborative, a collective. We pooled our money most of the time. But I think we were very, very well aware that as people from working class and low middle class backgrounds, that by doing that, we had access to the kinds of things that... I mean, access being another very, very important contemporary keyword, that we had access to other countries, to the kinds of food, to other people, to artists, to all sorts of things that we have. We also paid for childcare. It's very important. I mean, we come from a generation in which we had children, and we took those children on tour with us all the time as well. And we encouraged other people who had children to join us and work with all kinds, lots and lots of musicians. We were definitely maintained by the benefit system.
I mean, Tyrone told me a very interesting story. I presume it's true.
Yeah.
That in the early years of Thatcher's enterprise allowance, which was available to individual entrepreneurs, that being in a group formation meant you could actually apply for it more than once.
Yeah,
because there were multiple individuals in that group, and then
Like lots of people, we were definitely. And we also had lots of other part-time jobs as well.
Yeah.
You know, we did all the other things that people do. We probably did play the system a bit, but I think we had a tremendous kind of commitment towards sustainability. We never did have, I think it was a much later moment at which the Arts Council created things like, I don't know what they're called, like national, I don't know, are they called NPOs or NOPs or something? Mm-hmm. We never had any sustained funding. And in fact, I think, thinking back to what Kevin and Green were saying as well, we felt a tremendous sense of isolation. I mean, I'm looking at Kevin and I know that we're giving the impression of a very, very extraordinary culture. But one of the things that happened in art schools then was it wasn't people like us who were teaching us. We were the generation that went on to teach other people who've become the people who've created other things later. Many of the people like Jeff Nuttall and John Fox at Leeds were dropouts from Oxford. They weren't people who'd been educated, didn't come from state schools. They weren't part of the kind of world that we had at all. Mainstream was completely uninterested in us. There was no critical interest in what we did whatsoever. And the film I was going to show, I think, was when we finally went to Italy in our van and spent 3 months in an old school eating school dinners because we couldn't even get anywhere to rehearse in Leeds. Our Arts Council reports were so bad that we would often be taken aside and told that there would simply be no more funding for us. And it was partly that we were involved in this redemptive, transformative, semi-spiritual, prophetic kind of work, which did not meet highly materialist, very, very, very reductive economic left-wing politics at the time. And that doesn't mean we weren't radical, it just means we were absolutely somewhere else entirely. That's just way off the subject. But you know.
And can I pick up on something that you said, Claire? I mean, I was very taken with the Block quote.
I like that quote, 1932.
But you also said something quite interesting. You said about the working in a collective... allowed you to kind of, I don't know if these were your words,
yeah,
but
sure,
to kind of struggle towards possibilities that A, you could not express, and B, that you could never be sure what the intended consequences were going to be of whatever it is you were going to produce. I mean, do they ring true for you, Chris, as well, in terms of your work? And is there something that particular about collaborative, collective creation, as opposed to, let's say, an individual pursuit, which makes it less, makes one less able to predict, if you like, what might unfold.
Yeah, I mean, we have an attachment in Ponyboy, certainly, to very unpredictable, to work that emerges from the interlocking of a bunch of different systems. So whatever happens, particularly in front of an audience, is often totally unpredictable.
Yeah.
And it feels very important that those things sit in relation to an audience at a particular time,
yeah,
in a particular place, that we're trying to, you know, that even with Coyote trying to do that piece the day after the referendum, you know, on that Friday when everyone was feeling so fucking awful, it was to know that we had the possibility of making something happen that night that could be, in a sense, relevant to how people were feeling, or which we couldn't have done if we'd had a piece on tour. So that certainly resonates. Having said that, I think, again, particularly with Ponyboy, we have a very clear sense of a kind of relationship that we're seeking to establish with an audience, which is probably best... our work was described by an early reviewer who called Ponyboy an experimental performance boy band. And that sort of nails something about the kind of relationship that we're trying to establish with an audience. And in a sense, there's a real, there's a kind of a reckless abandon behind what we do, despite the fact that it's also very carefully controlled within all of those systems that I'm not quite describing. But we're also making, I think, trying to make a very energized and sort of attitudinous appeal to an audience. So it feels very, I think, performing with Ponyboy feels a lot like performing a musical. Do you know what I mean? It has that sort of that eye line that's energized and dynamic and seductive. And so in a sense, we have a very clear intent around our work. We're just not sure how we'll get there.
Mm-hmm.
But that I mean, we had some very interesting conversations in making the work this year, the piece that you saw, Fuck Systems, because we had sort of difficult second album syndrome a little bit, because we got to a point where we were able to have much more complex and sophisticated conversations about what it was that we were doing together, which meant that we had much better but much more intractable arguments about what it was that we're doing. And there was a really interesting conversation about whether it was permissible as Pony Boy for our doubt and our conflictedness to be part of what we presented on stage, or whether that was something that we tried to resolve in the rehearsal room in order to be able to present this kind of, this very appealing, energised, sort of single-minded quasi-boy band experience that's so visceral and so clear in some of its intentions. So I think, I mean, in a sense, you're describing something that's a really big conversation for us.
Yes, Claire.
Very, very, very quickly.
People have questions. Yeah. We'll be coming to you soon.
Ever so quickly, I think there's, in a sense, even individual artists are also collaborating. There's a sense in which you're profoundly informed by the work around you. So we were very informed by systems music, by all kinds of music, actually, by structuralism, by narrative film, by all kinds of artists that were around. But there's a big difference, I think, between art in which you're setting up the conditions under which meaning can emerge. And many kinds of things go into that: kinetic, visual, sonic, and even textual, and they might all have a kind of equivalence, and lots of that comes out of an earlier generation of artists, Cage and Cunningham, Rauschenberg, all kinds of people like that, and art in which there's a determined sense of following a kind of narrative, and I think Impact's work was the first. It's to do with setting up all kinds of conditions, some of them quite odd, some of them almost psychotropic, actually, and then seeing what happens out of that. So you're evolving a way to live in a completely alternate imaginary world, and then whatever happens on stage is part of that imaginary, imaginative, alter world.
Yes, we've got a question there, please.
It seems like what both of you are describing is a
sort of rejection of the traditional hierarchical relationship that exists in creating theatre. But to what extent, I mean, and Chris, you talked about the part of what you're creating is the group that you're creating it with. But to what extent do you ever feel that you can successfully eliminate the primacy of one creative voice in that collaborative process?
Yeah, that's really interesting.
Is it still Chris Good's Pony Boy?
I mean, it is, and that's something that the boys are properly cross about, and I understand why. And it's not something. I mean, it's something I suppose what I mean is that's something that happens at the level of kind of marketing and publicity and criticism, that my name gets attached sort of above the title or whatever in a way that feels absolutely sort of that again yanks us back to a model that we've never wanted to engage with, and I don't know quite how we climb out of that. I think something that's nice about Pony Boy is that we've worked very little with text, and so we are either all writers or none of us are writers, and that immediately alleviates some of the syntax that we're used to. And that still obtains in some of the places that I work with Chris Good and Company about whose singular vision is being served. That's not a place I like to work at all. But those residues are certainly present, even just as you know, bodily aversions, you know, allergies in the room. Those things are still there.
Is that in some way a bit like what you were saying, Claire, about how the Arts Council didn't understand what you were doing, or the, you know, the mainstream didn't understand it, so they can only see it through the prism that it understands?
Not really. I mean, I think that the zeitgeist was very, very different in the 1980s, and I think there was an enormous and very proper concern with issues from the left that needed to be explored, and those had unexpected consequences too. Many things came out of that. It wasn't a rejection of it. It was just the only thing we knew how to do, and it was fed by our own interests in art, music, film, and other things. It just wasn't. And also, how we were living was entirely well, not entirely, but the kind of cooperatively based. I've worked a lot with directors since then, but I think theatre's profoundly changed. I don't think it is based anymore around that model. There are so many multiple models.
Really depends where you are, though.
Yeah, of course it depends, yeah, but that's what I'm saying. There are multiple models, and it depends who you are, where you are, and what now you're in, what space you're in, you know, all kinds of different things. But the model has been absolutely exploded, I think, a long time ago.
I think it... I would say it persists. I mean, I...
Of course it persists.
But I think there is a central model that
but
we all define ourselves...
But we attend to the persistence. We attend... Well, I'm not sure, because that's a model of centre and margins that I also don't really agree with. I think we attend to the persistence rather than honouring the scattering and the multiplicity of alternatives. And that's something I've always wanted to do.
Yeah, no, I absolutely agree. But I think my experience of working in particular industrial situations is that that model is still absolutely central.
Yeah,
and that we still are required to define ourselves in relation to it.
Mm-hmm. Not least economic.
Yeah,
least.
Absolutely.
That's
you're right, Chris.
A transfunding of
Other voices? From the right-hand side of the room, the right brain? No?
Well, what I want to say...
Screen.
Green.
A quick
stand
thought,
up.
Collective endeavours are often short-lived and there's nothing wrong with that.
No, you're right.
There's a lot of tension, there's a lot of explosive, there's a lot of personal stuff, a lot of political stuff. I don't need a monkey.
You might need it.
That's possibly even a good thing, that these things burn out quickly, that there's an intensity of other people move on to other things. I also don't think there's anything wrong in a collective group with a division of labour. I mean, it doesn't matter if there's one of you in the room that can do... Even if the spotlight's on you, you know, you're the one with the voice or whatever, then that's fine. You know, I'll do something.
Yes.
Do you know what I mean? It doesn't have to, we don't all, there doesn't have to be the same voice or the same role. Mm-hmm.
I want to say something about friendship.
Also, very important, that what you said about centres and margins, I think that spatial metaphor is not a...
No, and I think I misrepresented Chris, but I wanted just to enter something into the conversation about friendship, because, I mean, one of the things that we're sort of getting towards here is that collectives are collectives about process and making, but they're also collectives which are, and cooperative workings and partnerships and DIY now too, about what basically was the kind of queering of culture that happened in the 80s. So they were about addressing very, very other kinds of hierarchies around the bourgeois family, around patriarchy, around our sexuality, the way that we were allowed to have children or not have children and to bring them up. And when I worked a little bit on Cage and Cunningham, the poet Robert Creeley once said that collaboration shortened the distance between he and I, and it enabled a process of hand-to-hand collaboration that enabled lifelong friendship. And I think that sense of honouring friendship amongst people, I mean, and those people are still my closest friends in Impact. But I think that friendship is a very, very underrated social structure, that those of us who always felt isolated from mainstream structures have been able to build. And I think it can help us now. I think it's really important, and that it has a real material presence in the world for us that we need to hang on to.
So this persists after the band has split, basically, is what you're saying.
Well,
right?
We didn't speak to one another. I mean, there are people I didn't speak to for, I mean, a long time. But that's life, you know. Mm. That's just the way things go.
I mean, the great exception to the rule about bands splitting up, of course, is the Mekons. They're still going on, still going strong. Some, what is it, nearly 30 years after... I mean, there's been many different many different membership... Mm. But they're still going strong, right?
I think that is interesting to talk about hierarchies, which isn't quite how I would characterise it, but it's, first of all, there's a truism there. Anybody who says they want to work collectively or think it's a good idea has never done it.
Yeah, absolutely.
it creates a framework and context in which you work, but within that, it can be very fluid.
Mm-hmm.
And people will emerge, like Reason says, over periods of time, But it does allow permeability and allow roles to be more fluid and allow people to find spaces for themselves and surprise each other. But it doesn't create an utter equality.
No.
It's not about equality, really, is it?
But it does allow a more fluid situation where people don't get entrenched, as in the hierarchy, which is why I think I'm not quite comfortable with that word. But it does allow certain people to run with the ball for a while and somebody else take a breather, and somebody else come forward. So it, as a process, it's very nurturing.
Yeah.
But as you said as well, Rina, it can be very difficult at times as well. Working collectively doesn't just have to happen with music or with theatre. We've done two collective major art shows, and there was a big difference between the two of them. And the first one was when we were all doing our own practice and kind of brought it together and kind of shoved it into the same box, and it was a disaster. And we kind of had to remind ourselves that that's not how you work collectively. The second one, we came with sets of ideas, which we discussed, we then started to generate work, and that made a much more coherent, much more interesting project. When we remembered that that's what you do when you work collaboratively, you leave a bit of yourself behind in order to allow more things to emerge.
Do you think there's now more self-consciousness about the difficulties of working collectively, given that we've had so many decades kind of radical collectivist practice in one field or another, and so we're more conscious of the limitations and the kind of stumbling blocks and all the rest of it? Or do you think we're just as much in the dark as perhaps once were, Claire?
Sorry about that. I think it's shifted. And when I was writing this chapter in this book, it's moved and morphed. And I think the words now, collaboration was not a word that we would have used. We're still tainted with a post-war kind of feeling anyway. We were anarcho-syndicalists working cooperatively. But I think now partnership, collaboration, collaborative working and dialogue are very much part of a wider sense of culture. They've also been bought, by the way. They've been bought. So there's a way in which a resistant kind of sense of what dialogue and conversation can be is really needs to be nourished. And ways to nourish that, tools to nourish that, I think, are what we want to be able to have.
Chris, you got an interest?
Just to make a point sort of adjacent to that, really, which is fascinating to me and a little bit scary, which is the way in which devising has become the central model for performance education.
Yeah, that's right.
So most students undertaking a performance or a theatre degree that's in any sense experimental, their principal experience will be of working collectively.
That's because we taught them. It's how it becomes. Yeah. We taught them to do it.
But what's interesting is how that then establishes a series of orthodoxies around methodology and around the sort of the implied politics of that. I suspect the actual politics of it don't get discussed much, or they're taken as though they were manifest. But it would be very interesting to see how as that continue, those people graduating from those courses continue to enter the sector, how things will shift, and whether there will be. I'm really hoping for devising's punk moment that comes along and explodes those orthodoxies and reminds us that something other than that brought us to the room in the first place.
Donna, are you...
I thought I was going to say something about this. A bit of a tangent, which might not be that helpful at this stage, but it might be really interesting to hear from some people who've been through art school recently whether you're also recognising this in terms of like the legacy of the 70s now being the people who are teaching people who are going through art school now. From what you've just said, Chris, is not what I think is happening in the visual arts in terms of how it's being taught, or certainly wasn't up until quite recently, probably, because the structures are completely different, in terms of this kind of relationship to the market, for example, and how an individual practice through some of the major art colleges have been incredibly focused on the market as the goal, you know, bringing your individual concept to market and somehow selling it. So the way that you're talking about theatre being taught is kind of the opposite to how the visual arts have been taught.
I think one of the things is that to think that collaboration is a lens rather than an element of education, if you like. So individual artists can have many forms of collaborative practice, conversational practice, working together. Do you see what I mean? I think one of the ways to think about it is that it's not as if we kind of shift from a moment in which everything's devising and then you can make the content of it collaboration. But if you think about it as a lens through which we might look at the culture, then the practice even of artists in the then looks really different. Do you see what I mean? I mean, it's we look at that whole notion of what it means to be collaborative, then it's everything from the one-to-one, the collaboration with the past, to many other kinds of things, and it allows us to see it rather differently, even in a very market-orientated culture, and perhaps to draw out from it the things that nourish future possibility.
No, I think the visual arts is coming out of that now, and the person I was hoping might say something is just put her hand up.
It was Erica. Ironically.
I didn't do a practice-based art degree. But one of the things that I've thought about a lot in terms of working collaboratively or with other people in my own practice, which I do, is because of my interest in kind of digital labour and all of the infrastructures around that, I often find myself coming up against this. It is basically a question around authorship, but the way that that relates to things like crowdfunding and the role of kind of collaboration in even things like Amazon, where, you know, Or things that the users contribute to. They're also the producers of the content. And sometimes as an artist, if you're kind of drawing on some of these structures where you're getting other people to contribute or drawing on other people's opinions in some way, there's so much thought has to go into what the pay structure is, what is the dynamic, what is the hierarchy of the artist to these others, if because of the way that the art market is, you can't put everybody's name on the bill, or at most you might be able to get a couple of other people's names. So then, are you just, it's that question of, are you then just replicating those infrastructures by which big corporations like Amazon get lots of other people to do work for them for their own profit? And so that, that tension between not really wanting to work on your own, but at the same time, the issues that collaboration in light of kind of digital labour bring up is something I've found quite difficult anyway.
Totally. Does anybody want to say anything to that? Is it you and me, Bom Bom Train, who's been in trouble over that?
Have they?
Yeah.
But then collaboration becomes a question. I mean, I think it's partly about what educative practices, autodidactic or others, enable us to be able to turn situations into useful questions, which is partly what your work continuously addresses. How might I turn this into a situation in which it can be exposed, in which we can work with it? And isn't that what art does? This constant fluid kind of turning from the material to what lies beyond it in order to do that. Which is not to say that those are not extremely important economic questions for artists as well. Sorry, Chris.
No.
Do we have any?
But I'd like to hear about other people's experiences, actually, in terms of either going to art school. I mean, that's one thing. But also just in terms of the terms that I'm hearing, transform is one, transition is another, even change itself, movement. What are the kind of the terms that are operating to unpick things that we're touching on, that become contested in the culture that we're in now, that are relevant to what we're talking about? Anybody? Somebody there? Charlotte, tell us. Well, one word, if you were to say the kind of couple of words of the moment, what would they be? Yeah.
I just think we're missing what I think is really important about collectives is that it's an anti-capitalist notion. Like, if we're talking about the individual as an artist in art school, making themselves marketable, the whole point of a collective to me is that it's skill sharing.
Do you want to claim it for anti-capitalism? Do you want to claim the collective for anti-capitalism?
I mean, it's for people's interpretation, but
you can't say both those things. You can't claim it and then say it's open to interpretation.
I mean, I don't know. Do you think?
But I absolutely, it's really important, the anti-capitalist thing.
Yeah, I mean, I guess we use that word. I was just thinking that as we were talking about this. I was like, oh, what, you know, but that's because it's, like, recognisable to people. And I don't know, like, I don't think, yeah. I can totally see the neoliberal.
Go on, Charlotte,
thing,
put the microphone up and okay. Say it. It's great what you're saying.
but I just, yeah, like, I've lost my train of thought. Just that, yeah, I think it's just being understandable to a lot of people, and that is like reference. Yeah, that is in like radical sort of culture that is still used as a reference point.
About free schools and
yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So that higher education is beyond the means of the working class generally in this country. Mm-hmm. Then collective working means that. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, collective working just opens the doors for people to learn from each other.
Absolutely.
And I think that especially goes against the state quite mm-hmm. often as well. And the way that we're made to kind of fight against each other within capitalism. Right. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
We've got a comment or question.
Yeah.
Yeah, that just seems this is a really, really important issue. I'm at Cambridge School of Art at the moment. And I'm actually speaking here next week as part of the sustainability with Cambridge. And one of the first things we're starting with, and one of the first points that we thought that we would embark on, is skill sharing mm-hmm. and just continuing that social aspect of what we can learn from each other.
Yes.
And any kind of capitalist view just doesn't come into it at all. And I feel really lucky to be a part of something like that. And I feel that in a great many institutions, that's at threat of being lost in the economic climate that we're in at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Mm. It's a really good one. Other people, I mean, that sense that capitalism itself, I didn't even say that was a key word now, but is under pressure. But is it our responsibility, and I was being, you know, saying claim it, to really put it under pressure? And what does that mean? What tools do we have to put it under pressure that are not reductive tools? They're not the tools of a kind of old left that says, actually, it all comes down to economics. We know that culture in itself is a, and I know you're not doing that, I'm being devil's advocate, but that it's that actually we can put it, how do we put it under pressure? You two are putting it under pressure. But that's a really important thing for us to think about.
And then we've got somebody's
there. Yeah, carry on.
I'm not sure if this is just going to come out in a splurge of words. Okay. I was just thinking that I'm doing fine art at the moment at Falmouth, and I'm also in a dance theatre performance company. And it's really interesting to compare the two and how mm-hmm. The art school, the art degree structure is very much now confined by the fact it's a business, and it's and everything is to do with kind of this individualistic approach to moving towards a career and money making, and as opposed to the performance group that I'm in, which is very much collaborative, not to do with money, not to do completely outside of that world. And it's really, I think that's the most valuable thing about it, is the fact that it is a collaboration. And what you were saying about how do we work against how do we kind of change capitalism, I think the thing that's most fundamentally problematic in our society alongside that is the lack of empathy. And I think the key thing in collaboration mm-hmm. is that it increases our empathy. And that was the main thing that I took away from my experience in a collaborative group, is empathy and the kind of infinite possibilities of creativity that come from that.
This is quite interesting, listening to that from a student that's was studying at Falmouth, because I did another MA at Falmouth 10 years ago, and the culture within how the political framework has changed in 10 years from a university, studying fine art in that university, we were given so much free will, given so much space, and now the same MA, the same degree, is completely commercially driven. And it's a shame because the experience has lessened a great deal over that 10 years.
So we're going to ask all the artists who've made enormous amounts of money of my generation, seriously. When I first went to Leeds in 1971, I was 16, and there was a very important, and I can't remember the name of it now, collective, which was about taking the money, people offering money from previous generations to fund the projects of our generation. And so where are we? I mean, there is an enormous amount of capital floating around in the art world. Where are we going to access the nourishing financial means with the trust that we and faith that we might want to have to take on those next projects? Is it that we have to do it ourselves, or do we continue to ask it of the state?
Which is, was a collaborative, it was one of the first ones in London, so I was taught by him and it was pretty rad. And
then, I didn't hear any of that, can you say it again? Put the, yeah.
Hey.
You need to go to a what? Go on.
You need to go to a different school. Well, I think it's just a variety of schools that you need to go to, just because I was taught, well, I went to Westminster and I was taught by Peter Owen and he set up City Racing, and that was, yeah, he was really influential in the terms of like collaboratives and working together and that, this, that, and that. And then I went to Royal College, and then Baseman took over from Wentworth Sculpture, and he brought in a different perspective again. Like, no one got, like, there's a few guys got picked up from the for the galleries and shit like that, but nobody really wants to get picked up anymore, not from like Royal College. It's more about the art for itself, like the truth, like that value, like the stoniness of the stone, man.
Nothing better than those incredible transformative individuals who can really change you in education, is there? And to name them is part of honouring that tradition. So Richard Wentworth is one, and who's the other one?
No, it wasn't Richard Wentworth, man. It was Jordan Baseman.
He's gone. I can hear.
Yeah. Baseman. Baseman took over on Peter Owen.
Okay.
Yeah.
Both of you went to.
Yeah.
So, and where did Peter? Where did Peter Owen go to college? Anybody know?
No idea.
He was with Paul Noble. He was all guys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And but again, it came out of a position of anger, and also taking the piss out of the art world.
Yeah.
Which in a way is what the whole punk thing was about as well.
Yeah.
There was an anger there. So in a way, I feel like we need to be angry again, and you know, take a position. And I think starting your own collectives and working together is the only way. We can't rely on the state anymore.
It's also over generation to generation, hand to hand, isn't it? Brilliant. Somebody else, come and.
Well, we're,
no,
out,
we're out
of
sorry,
time.
Gavin, taking
I'm,
John.
I'm a
there's one more at the back, more. Definitely. Yeah. At least one more at the back. Here, go on.
I think there's an increasing issue with the word sustainability. It's become part of the rhetoric of arts funding,
yeah.
Arts organisations, actually doing things which are unsustainable. Is a lot more radical, a lot more energising, a lot more interesting. Things can live in a moment and be mm-hmm. quite special. And they might go on to become, you know, some might go on to have a longer life. But if we're completely bound by issues of sustainability constantly, then this is just deadening, absolutely deadening.
That's interesting. Well, we have no more time, I'm afraid. So let's thank our panellists.
Hi everyone, thanks for coming back and not staying out in the lovely sunshine, although it's tempting. So I'm Donna Linus, I'm a director at Wysing, and I'm chairing this final session, which is called DIY to DIT, so from do it yourself to do it together. And this session is sort of bringing us up to date, and I thought maybe I should just give a little bit of background into the whole Wysing Poly thing and why this session kind of came about within the context of Gavin's sort of curation of the day. So Wysing, you know,
we put a lot of structures in place to allow these kind of discussions to take place, but always thinking about the kind of relevance of the moment. And we theme each year into kind of, it kind of emerges from the previous year in a quite organic way, actually from these kind of events. So I am pretty certain that some of the things that will have been discussed today will eventually emerge into next year's theme and programming. And really what we're trying to do actually with the poly is that emerged from a sort of an event that happened last summer when we started talking in an event quite like this around where were the radical spaces of art practice happening now. And because in the past, perhaps we looked to the art college for that space. And, you know, I think what we've heard is that at the time, people were also looking for that in art colleges, but perhaps from, you know, someone like me looking back with a nostalgia and rose-tinted spectacles, you know, perhaps it wasn't like that in the way that we think it was. And that was a very problematic time as well, of course. In terms of which voices were heard in the structures. So in a way, what we're trying to do here and through the poly program is to set up alternative structures to allow these kind of discussions to take place that will then feed into a wider discourse in terms of art practice. And obviously, you know, it's no accident that we're looking to the 1970s as a period not to be forgotten or allowed to disappear, you know, that to keep it alive by talking about it because of the reemergence of the left over the recent years in Europe. And at the time when we put together this, the concept of the poly, you know, there was a real genuine optimism around a potential new era of the left in the UK. And I guess we thought, by at this point, we would be, you know, we'd have all had our sleeves rolled up, start to think about a different future for this country, and that we'd all be, you know, working forever naive and optimistic, of course. But in a way, that is happening, I guess. But it's happening in a more, in a way that's much more immersed and, you know, it's much more sort of crossing lots of different disciplines. It looks at, you know, music is extremely important, writing is important. There's a kind of re-emergence of poetry that's happening that's really important. So in a way, we're also trying to capture that moment and think, well, you know, what is happening now? What does it mean? How can the arts play a role within politics and sort of offer alternatives where things aren't working? So for example, we set up in collaboration with a group of peers across the UK an alternative learning program that was about trying to set up an opportunity for someone who couldn't afford to do an MA or didn't want to have to come and work with us and, you know, and the partners in a collaborative way to go through a process that might be similar to an MA, or what we thought would be the dream MA, you know, that we would have all loved to have done if we'd had the opportunity. So in a way, you know, I think there is a sort of an urgency around arts organisation taking the initiative on these kinds of, offering these kind of alternatives and allowing different voices to come out in programming that's not about purely exhibition-driven programmes, although of course there's a place for that. And I think there are, you know, there's a lot of good things happening across the UK and we can celebrate it and talk about it and think about what the next phase, you know, in terms of the politics might be. And I guess we can't really get away from the fact that, you know, the struggles that are happening right now within the UK in terms of like this kind of re-emergence of the left and how that connects to Europe and what's going on there. So perhaps it would be good to touch on that a little bit. But, you know, I'm really happy to have some speakers here today whose work completely is, you know, is doing everything that we've been talking about. And then we've also got Amy Proctor, whose book...
Spencer.
Oh, sorry. No, but you're
Spencer.
Sorry.
Spencer.
Sorry.
I wasn't sure if I should
name. No, yeah. You should. Sorry, Amy Spencer.
Yeah, don't worry.
Sorry about that.
Okay.
His book here, you know, The Rise of Lo-Fi Culture, which Amy, you know, is going to be able to give us a little bit of flavour of kind of the emergence of lo-fi culture coming out of, surprisingly to me, actually was the States in the 1930s. I don't know if you want to go back that far, but it also relates to something that someone else said around, you know, tapping into a moment in the 1970s when, in fact, there was an influence coming from places like San Francisco or bands like the Velvet Underground coming from New York. You know, in a way, that had a huge effect on UK culture, so it would be really great to hear more about that. And also, you know, thinking about how the visual played a role in this kind of milieu that we're talking about. So looking, you know, at some of Kevin's aesthetics, it's very much like the aesthetic that still kind of continues around this DIY culture in terms of the handmade, and how holding on to that aesthetic seems really important as well. So we're going to start with Amy. Shall I just hand over straight to you?
Yes, or do we need that instead of...
Shall we try it with these mics first?
It looks like it's on. Maybe it is. Who knows? Hand me that if people can't hear. So I wanted to start by introducing some of the ideas from my book, which... So this is a book I wrote, DIY, the Rise of Lo-Fi Culture. It was quite a while ago. So the first edition was published in 2006, so... It was a cut-off point. I've still been involved in DIY culture after that, but if you read that, you'll realise that there's not so much about the internet, because, you know, I haven't just forgotten to put a lot of things in it. That's when I wrote it. I wanted to start off by introducing some of the ideas of that book in particular, thinking about do-it-yourself culture and sort of exploring a little bit about what those ideas mean to me. Because as I started writing this book, I realised that it meant different things to different people over different times in particular. And I started tracing where some of the ideas came from. So to me, it's about using anything you can get your hands on to shape your own cultural product and whatever version, whatever you think is missing from a kind of wider mainstream culture. It's about the urge to produce something for yourself and in turn pass it on to other people. It's about championing a sense of independence. If you don't see yourself represented in the media, it's about creating your own media. It's about using resources available to you, even though those might be limited resources. And it's about crossing the boundary between who consumes and who creates. That's the thing that kind of excites me, that it's not a certain person who produces and creates something. Anybody can take part, and there's this kind of ethos, a kind of championing of anybody taking part. It's about the amateur approach being valued as a finished product and not as a stepping stone on the way to being a professional. It questions the idea of the expert, and it's about people experimenting with what they can do themselves. It's about getting involved, and it's about community. And as I was doing my research for that book, I realised that this idea had kind of spread through different creative and political communities, and people who are working as individuals and also as groups had used this kind of idea to create their own cultural forms. And the kind of activity that I looked at is vast, and it covers activities such as music, self-publishing, zine making, journalism, filmmaking, activism, crafting, art and technology. So many things can be DIY. It's evolved through digital culture, and opportunities available online now completely kind of exploded what I think of as DIY. But kind of changes in technology have always played a really important part in do-it-yourself culture. Different waves of kind of creative output have always coincided with developments in technology. So as cassette tapes became more affordable, then, you know, bands use cassette tapes to record and produce as a means to distribute music. So it kind of spent a lot of time kind of tracing how technology impacted DIY culture. And the book in particular explores the idea of DIY in publishing and music within the UK and US. And the aim of it was to try and work out what the roots of do-it-yourself culture were, because I noticed there were different ways of working that kind of echoed through different communities, similar ways of working, familiar styles that appeared in lots of different forms. So, for example, I looked at how the zine, a kind of small-scale, cheaply produced publication, was first produced by sci-fi fans in the 1930s in America and developed into a format used by anyone. And then those were used to inspire music zines, and fiction writers and activists use the same kind of cheaply produced format. And then I looked at punk scenes in the 70s and saw how the aesthetics of those were directly taken from earlier art movements, such as futurists, Dada, situationists, Fluxus art movements. I saw that activities started by pirate radio stations were then later used in podcasts, so I was kind of got really interested in tracing how things were repeating, different people were doing different things at different times. This book wasn't a kind of critical engagement with the subject, it was just me as somebody who had a personal background in do-it-yourself culture, so from writing zines when I was a teenager to releasing records and just the idea that you could do something yourself from your hometown and kind of send it out into the world really gripped me from quite a young age, so I was really inspired by that. And so later on, I really wanted to kind of explore how other people had used this. And as I wrote about DIY culture, and one of the things that I realised was really important, as it was important to me, is the idea of trying to find a community, a kind of sense of that there are other people a bit like you out there. And a key strength of DIY for me is that it celebrates this kind of artistic activist community. So this could be a close physical community in a city where you have opportunities to share resources, music equipment, printing equipment, physical spaces, or it could be this kind of a wider sense of community that supports individual activities. So a zine writer, someone producing these kind of publications, might live a long way away from a sense of physical community, but might feel connected to a wider community. So they might, for example, when I wrote zines, the postal network was how I communicated to people. I sent my zines to people and they sent zines back to me, and we kind of connected this really big, this was in kind of the mid-90s in the UK. You could communicate with people you didn't really know just by writing letters to them, and they would send 50p and they'd send a zine, and then the back page of a zine you would find all the addresses for zines to send your 50p to, and it was fun. And also I started exploring the sense of collaboration within the DIY community. So due to this blurring of the division between who creates and who consumes, between who's an amateur and who's an expert, and a democratic ideal of who should be involved, there's this feeling that people are willing to be open and collaborate with each other. And it's difficult to assess whether this is always the case, whether it's a kind of idealized feeling or whether it's, you know, it's actually what happens. But there are all these... you kind of see the output of people collaborating with each other. And there are thousands of writers and musicians who wouldn't have created, I don't think, without the supportive ethos behind them, this idea that anyone can do it. And there's this kind of rallying call to become involved. And this forms a sense of doing it together rather than just having to do it all yourself, this kind of feeling that you're in it with other people. And in particular, I think that the building of a zine community, which was what I was particularly involved in is due to the personal nature of many zines. So it's a kind of cultural product that is often a documentation of everyday life. And academic and writer Chris Atten recognises that personal paper-based zine is a form of cultural production firmly rooted in everyday life. So writers often write about their own experiences and produce elements of their own life in paper form. Writers might be writing about their own lives, what's important to them, and the music that they're listening to. So lots of zines that I looked at in this book particularly were quite personal zines. People just writing about aspects of their own life or kind of niche interests that they had that they wanted to share with other people. So it might be a particular television programme they were watching and got really obsessed with and wanted to share, or a particular interest that they had and wanted to reach out to other people. And one of my favourite things about zines is you can see the evidence of the creator in them. So in the history of zine writing, emerging in the, particularly as we know, emerging in the 70s and 80s and into the 90s when I was writing zines, there's been this kind of dominant visual style, in part inspired by earlier art movements, and this often still remains in zines today. So text can often be handwritten, cut and paste techniques are used, and you can see how the zines are constructed. And there's often a sense of immediacy and urgency in DIY cultural products, that they can't survive long term and they need to say whatever they want. They need to say everything they can in a kind of immediate, short space of time. This kind of urgency runs through them. And the aesthetic of a zine often implies this sense of immediacy, the feeling that everything has to be said right now and it won't last forever. Energy is kind of concentrated and released in this burst of activity. And particular zines might not last for very long, just maybe a few issues. But there's always this kind of optimism that in this short space of time they'll kind of reach their audience and the people writing them will find the community that they were looking for. and kind of the achieve what the zine particularly is about. Yeah, I think I'll leave it there for that introduction. Now hopefully we'll hear some more about practical examples. Thank you.
Just before we move on, actually, just one thing that you said towards the end there that I think would be good to maybe unpick a little bit more, especially in this context of alternative learning or structures for, because in a way, what Green described when he moved to London and set up Scritability as a kind of cooperative movement, you know, working in squats, and it struck me that that was almost like setting up your own art school, like post-art school or something. Yeah, it was it felt very much like a learning experience. And then when I was reading your book, I was thinking, well, actually, you know, the process of producing zines and the fact that everyone who contributes then writes for someone else in their zine, and then it becomes this really concrete, almost like a physical object, the network becomes incredibly concrete. And in a way, is that also offering a different kind of vehicle for a learning platform almost? Or am I reading too much?
No, it's interesting. I think because I don't have an art school background, so it's not a way I've thought of it before, but definitely the kind of network, particularly when I was writing scenes, did feel like a kind of a really important thing, but more from a sense of community and a feeling of making connections with people you might not usually meet.
There was almost a currency about, well, I'll support your zine if my writing is... And then you would sort of naturally put that person in your next edition kind of thing. And that sort of strengthened this kind of...
Yeah, I definitely see that. But I can see how that would work, the kind of sharing of ideas. And but I think for me it didn't feel like that at the time. Like now looking back on it, I would read it as that, and I would think, oh yeah, I was trying to, it was about learning and sharing ideas and trying out things. But then when I think about what I was actually writing when I was 16, it didn't feel as serious as that, even though it felt, it wasn't so much the testing of ideas, it was more kind of documenting how I was feeling about things.
Yeah. And making connections.
Yeah, making connections with other people and then, kind of growing into the world through that. Okay.
All right. Does anyone want to ask a question, pitch in at this point? Of course, Gavin.
I mean, it's a remarkable project, initiative, whatever we want to call it. But I just wanted to say two things. Firstly is that and I think it echoes what I think it was Chris that said this earlier, that, you know, a lot of the energy that goes into, a lot of the labour that goes into the making of this thing goes into the kind of making and the sustaining of the group, right? And but perhaps more particularly of the infrastructure of the group, because as you were talking, I was thinking, you know, you're in multiple music bands, but you're also a kind of key member of the collective of DIY Space for London as well. Whereas, you know, in the previous historical moment we've been considering, correct me if I'm wrong, but for the most part, it seemed to be that you were either in a band or you were somebody who was involved in kind of setting up the infrastructure. That might not be true, but I'm thinking about Tony Wilson, people like that with Factory Records, people who set up Rough Trade. Right, yeah. Scratch that then. Okay, leave that one. Okay, it's exactly the same. Leave that one.
But do we? We do actually need more spaces like this, don't we? Because that's really the only way that we're going to get through the next few years. And someone said earlier, actually, it was you, Claire, about, you know, the responsibility of the older generation to support, not just about giving platforms for this kind of work, but also actually funding it, you know, and there is a precedent actually, which is that well-known YBA artist Gary Hume gives £70,000 of his own money to goldsmiths for artists to have who couldn't afford it to have bursaries to study, and I really think somehow we need to draw on that and push it really hard and sort of start to say, like, how do we actually somehow work together to think about how to keep these kind of spaces alive and from not to get squashed out of the system, because things are going to get really tough again. Evelyn's got a question.
Hi. I was really hoping I wouldn't have to say this, or at least I was hoping it wouldn't have to be me that would have to say this, but I just wanted to kind of draw attention to the whiteness of this event. And even as I'm saying this, I'm like frustrated and exhausted. And especially kind of thinking about this moment of ongoing crisis that we're in, and just this is just not good enough. Like, it's just really not good enough right now, you know? And to kind of have this event framed around welfare and austerity measures and you know, living in this moment where actually these measures are only going to get worse, and we're not really thinking about the people who are disproportionately affected by these measures, and actually none of their voices are part of this conversation, you know? So I'm thinking, like, what's going on? You know, and actually also just to be clear, I'm actually only here because I'm on a residency here. You know, I wouldn't have been here had I been in London, which is where I'm usually based. So it's also important to kind of draw attention to that. So my question is, like, why are we here? Because there's a lot of we that's being mentioned, but actually, who is that we? It's like, what are we doing? What is the aim of this conversation that's happening today? And actually, who is it that we're trying to speak to? You know, who is it that we actually want to be in solidarity with when we're talking about collectivism and working together? It's like, who is it that you actually want to work with? And actually, I feel like part of this issue is one of legibility. You know, how, because I'm seeing these moments in time that are being mentioned around, you know, music, around punk, and around, and actually I'm seeing a really particular kind of punk, because actually my definition of punk looks really different, you know. So I'm thinking about how is it that radicality is perceived? How is it that anarchism is perceived? Is it to be squatting? Is it to be, you know, being able to work for free? And it's like, actually, for some people, that is just not an option, you know. So again, I'm thinking about legible, you know, what does it mean to appear? What does it mean to be visible to certain kind of modes of thought? And also I'm thinking about that actually a lot of the people that are being brought up in terms of the theory are particularly Western, particularly white continental philosophers. And actually, you know, there's not been any kind of mention of a kind of, and I think, you know, it needs to be part of this conversation we're having, especially in this moment, around kind of post-D and anti-colonial kind of thinkers, you know, really need to be brought into the conversation. Like, for example, Edouard Glisson's notion of opacity. You know, this, you know, what does it mean to not be understood, and actually to have the right to not be understood, and actually how do we figure out ways to work together collectively when we don't understand each other? We might not necessarily speak the same language, you know, and how we appear and how our politics manifest might be different, but we need to figure something out, you know what I mean? Like, we really, really do, because not everybody has the luxury to engage in these activities like squatting and, you know, all of these things that, I don't know, they seem so much a part of this conversation, but actually they're not part of everybody's conversation, you know, so I just want to make that clear as well. And you know, and I'm frustrated because this keeps on happening, you know, it keeps on happening, and actually this is partly why we're here. You know what I mean? Like, this is partly why we're here in this moment in time, because we're not really having conversations, you know, outside of our kind of immediate comfortable groups. And so the point that I want to make, it's not really a question, sorry, it's just because I've been kind of holding this in for the whole day, and I just want to say that we can't keep organising events in the same way, with the same unbalanced set of speakers. We can't keep writing the same set of books that don't look at histories intersectionally. You know what I mean? And kind of, you know, we can't keep not moving beyond the legible, you know, and what we understand. So, yeah.
Thank you for that contribution. I mean, you are a part of the conversation by being here and making contributions of that kind. And I'm very, very conscious of the whiteness of the panel, and obviously I would have preferred it to be otherwise. It's an extremely short panel, as you know, 12 till 5, and that doesn't excuse anything, but it means that the range of perspectives that we've been able to consider have been necessarily kind of partial and very far from comprehensive, and that's why it was so important to open up the discussion to the people who came along today, because you're absolutely right that the histories of punk and post-punk in particular are incredibly important in terms of a bigger story of the development of multicultural Britain, for example, especially when we bring into the picture the communities around reggae music. And what's so kind of interesting, I think, just going back to Leeds, which is what I would have loved to have brought to the table, is, for example, at that time, I talked about the amount of working class students that were allowed to go to art school, you know, back in the day when it was free, but that economic, if you like, the lack of an economic barrier didn't mean it was necessarily any more kind of pluralistic in terms of, of race and ethnic background. The students who were going to university were still largely white at that time, not exclusively so. And why was it that there wasn't more non-white people getting involved in post-punk music? Because in large part wait a minute, I'm just about to say something because what was happening in Leeds, for example, there were experimental black collectives going on, but in relationship to dance, for example, if sure, Tyrone Huggins was in Impact. They're, absolutely. But what I'm talking about is a community that didn't go to art school in Leeds, but made radical experimental collectivist work, came out of Hare Hills and Chapel Town schools. Yes, I do know what you mean, and if I was to organise the event over again, I would most definitely have somebody, maybe even Christy Adair or somebody from that community to come and speak about that practice.
I'm totally ashamed, partly because I wrote about a lot of black practice in my own collective thing, but I am really ashamed, actually, that I didn't rehear what I needed to say myself. But the thing I really want to say is that it's not about the black community, it's talking about black intellectuals, actually. And I actually think about Black Audio Film Collective, who I wrote about here. But I don't think it's about reggae music and the black community. It's about actually contribution to intellectual ideas. And I'm really sorry that I forgot to hear that, because it's just, if it's too easy for me not to hear it, then it's really easy for everybody not to hear it.
Well, let me tell you that John Acomfra was invited to be here today, and obviously the Black Audio Film Collective was one of the first collectives that I wanted to be represented here. Unfortunately, he couldn't make it. So that's the truth of the matter.
You know, it's there were other people as well that could have been brought into the conversation. No, that's it. Thank you, Lotte.
We're about to finish. Like, it's 5 o'clock. We're supposed to finish now. Does anyone have anything else that they, you know, without taking off on the tangent? I guess we are going to stop now. Has anyone got anything else that they feel like they want? Yeah.
It's just very quick, but what is going to come out of this event, do you think? Anyone?
I mean, I suppose the point of having these kind of events is to bring people together, to have these conversations and start to unpick some of the... I mean, were you aware of DIY space before you came here? Well, or you were, or I mean, that's why you came. I mean, it's about talk, about sort of bringing some of this stuff out so we can talk about it. So, yeah, I guess it's the net. There is another event coming up, and actually I've just realised we were supposed to talk a lot more about the role of online space as spaces of community, which is what the next event is about. So, yeah, the purpose of any kind of event like this is about starting conversations. So hopefully people will come back to future ones and we can continue the conversations, we can listen to what's being said, and obviously it also impacts in terms of, you know, there are people in this room who program arts organisations, so presumably they might start thinking about how they might take some of what we've been hearing back to their organisations as well. But it is, you know, it's supposed to be about sharing knowledge, ultimately.
Yeah, I was just wondering what the initial idea was that kind of...
The initial idea?
That sparked you to create this event.
So, yeah, so it was just... I guess it was because we were looking at this... You know, like I was just describing, last summer we had an event where we were starting thinking about where spaces of radical practice exist now. Because we were talking about the demise, you know, sort of like this, the journey that art schools have been on from talking about art to talking about the creative industries and what's been lost in that process. So this kind of trying to look back somehow at something that happened pre-Thatcherism actually, and capitalism and neoliberalism in the UK, specifically rooted in UK art schools, and talking about Gavin's research around Leeds at the time. So yeah, that's why. But it was supposed to be looking back to a time that was definitely not perfect, but trying to just perhaps think about, is there something going on now that's allowing these kind of conversations to re-emerge?
It feels like now that we're in such a kind of crisis state and everything's being thrown up in the air,
yeah.
There should be now, from going forwards, more opportunities to discuss issues and think about who's being represented and who's not being represented. And yeah. I feel like everyone here should commit themselves to not making mistakes, me too, that we need to address how we're representing, and especially in the time of current upheaval, it's an opportunity, not a good opportunity, but an opportunity to rethink how we're doing things and what we're doing. I think personally, yes. I'm feeling that in all of me now.
There's a lot uncovered, a lot of commonalities between what's happening now and then. But there's one thing that is an extremely big difference, and it's something you were saying about being able to afford to do this.
Yeah.
And I've mentioned it outside of this room, but I want to say it, but we have the dole.
Yeah.
40 quid a week. What Stockseekers announced now, 75? And it was a very light touch dole.
Yeah.
You had to sign on, but that was it.
Mm-hmm.
You couldn't.
Yeah, exactly. All that shit.
What the system is,
stuff that we did, we wouldn't have been able to do without. You know, we could at least feed ourselves and live in a place. I don't know how you do it.
And a lot of work I've been doing after writing this book and being involved in DIY myself, realising how not everybody's voice is being heard. So spending a lot of time myself kind of working with different groups, particularly in kind of writing projects. So I spent the last 10 years working with kind of homeless groups and exploring the idea of how to share your writing and how to share your voices, and lots of just a huge variety of groups, feeling that I didn't just want to hear my voice all the time, but trying to engage with other people. And yeah, just I feel like that's the kind of trying to find new spaces and new...
Gavin, do you want to say anything, actually?
I just want to say thank you to Donna and to Lottie and to all of the staff here at Wysing
for facilitating our conversations today, to all the contributors who shared their reflections with us, and obviously to everybody here who has contributed and who has sat and listened intently, and hopefully the conversations will continue, we'll learn from today, and see what will happen.